is the Calabria region, the scene for the opening prologue time trial, a veritable sprint of just 1.1 kilometres, a little more than half a mile for the 197 starters in this year's event. And although assembly here is on a beautiful day, by the time we get to the back end of the prologue, we'll be racing in the dark today because this is very much an evening event. Phil Liggett with Paul Sherwin, Eric Zabel, Paul, his first ever Giro d'Italia.
Yeah, rather strange, and I think that may well be because that Eric Zabel is not quite sure whether or not he's going to make T-Mobile's squad for the Tour de France this year. Should be a great prologue time trial for Alessandro Petacchi. He certainly is a specialist over the sprinting leg of this course. Gilberto Simoni looking very comfortable, looking to try and get himself another win.
The big question mark, of course, is who will be the boss of the Lamprey Cafeta team, Damiano Cunego or Gilberto Simoni? Cunego, remember, snatching victory a year ago. Let's pick up the action. This is just a little look back to the way it used to be. He's now retired, Mario Cipollini, riding the course and receiving the applause of the crowd. What a great entertainer he has been. He holds the record for stage wins in the Giro d'Italia, and it is now very much a goodbye to Big Mario.
Well, Mario Cipollini certainly gave us some excitement over the last few years, and once again there. This year, Phil, I think he won't be too worried about the tunic that he's donned here for the Giro d'Italia, because as he's not a competitor, he won't be getting fined.
Right, this is the situation now as we catch up to Sato, his best time in the finish line at the moment. As the riders, it's a veritable straight sprint. This is the 42nd rider to go today. Brett Lancaster from Australia, part of the world record-breaking team pursuit squad, set the world record at 3:56. An incredible ride over 4,000 metres. Now he's only got to ride 1,000, just slightly over 1,100 metres.
Well, if you can ride the sort of speeds he's done at the Olympic Games, which is covering a kilometre in around about 57 seconds, he's got a very good chance. But of course, let's not forget, this is actually from a standing start. He's looking at the time, though, of Matteo Tosato, a time of a minute and 21 seconds.
For 1.1 kilometres, a very fast time indeed. Very hot and humid evening here. Not to any wind about at all. And you can't get lost on this course. And just look at the speed here of Brett Lancaster. This is without doubt his favourite discipline. He races for the Italian Panaria shock squad, the same team as Graham Brown, who sadly is not here. After a great start to the season in Lancari, he's not ridden too well with illness and injury since. But Lancaster is going to be very, very close here to the time of Tosato, because he's holding the left of the seaside of the course here. 1:21 the time to beat.
Well, look at that. He's right on the front of the saddle there. Look at the way he's ticking those pedals over. Very high cadence. This man knows what it's like. His body will be absolutely burning at this point.
Well, the cars are turned off now. He's on his own here. No more words of advice from the manager. And he is driving on. He wants you to do well. He's inside, is he? Well, 1:20.958 is the official time. I thought he'd gone over there, but that is the best time. And there's the confirmation then. We're opening the Giro d'Italia with a win by an Australian, Brett Lancaster. It's been done before, don't forget, by Bradley McGee, but Lancaster will become only the third Australian ever to pull on the Maglia Rosa of the leader of the Tour of Italy. And who better to donate it tonight than Mario Cipollini?
Cipollini, I don't know if you can just see the lines down the outside of that skin suit. Every one of those is the names of the individual stages that Mario Cipollini has won over the years. He's got the World Championship bands there as well. And I have to say that is certainly an honour, I would say, Phil, for Brett Lancaster to receive his first Maglia Rosa from Mario Cipollini.
Goodbye to Mario. Hello, Brett. Now, well, he's going to have to put up with a long stage today to try and keep the jersey. It'll be a difficult task for him. He's done what he wanted to do, though, and that was get off to a pink jersey start, as we now race right along the coast today before we swing inland. 197 riders are going to take the start today. We're on to Tropea. Undulations and no huge mountains. We do have a third category climb on the way before we plunge down onto the coast, and it could be a good battle for the sprinters as we approach the finish.
Well, of course, riders like Alessandro Petacchi will be looking to try and get himself some time bonuses out on the course, because, in fact, although Lancaster won that opening prologue, his time advantage is only 1 second. The actual official time we won by, Phil, was only 0.289 of a second. So there's going to be a big battle for the Maglia Rosa at the end of today's stage.
And as usual in the Giro d'Italia, the Intergiro sprint carries a time bonus, while at the finishing line too, you get the regular bonuses at the finish of 20, 12 and 8 seconds. 3:21 at the Intergiro, going to be a crucial first sprint there today when we get to Lockery after 92 kilometres covered.
Tom Steele's just riding through there.
One or two riders in the pack there. Don't look too fit to me, Paul, as they rolled out, but here we go. We're picking up the finishing sprint here at 5 kilometres from the finishing line. Sven Kraus has taken out this 3-second sprint bonus, Zanini second, and Tormwald Venneberg is first. Venneberg will be the first leader to in the King of the Mountains as we now line up here for the last 4.5 kilometres, and as expected, it's all together.
Good line on the outside there. You can just see a line of blue and white jerseys. That's Alessandro Patacchi's team, and they're trying to get themselves organised. But this is, I think, rather a dangerous run into the finish. This is the corner the riders will come through in a few moments' time, and I hope a lot of the riders, Phil, today have had a look at the race Bible, because there is a very difficult, tortuous run in to the finishing line.
Well, Pataki's team, after his brilliant record-breaking number of post-war stage wins last year, seems to have got themselves organised on the far right of the road. The Silver Bullets, as we call them these days. This is going to be their last year in sponsorship as well, which is rather sad.
Daniel El Deluca right up at the front there in the white jersey, number 151. He's the leader of the Pro Tour. This is a Pro Tour event nowadays. There you can just see riding up at the front there, Robbie McHugh, an Australian national champion, looking for the wheel of Alessandro Patacchi. Alessandro Patacchi is such an incredible lead out, Phil, but they're approaching that rather tricky corner any moment now as we come up to 4 kilometres to go.
Well, it's been a long opening day at 208 kilometres, but we're now into the last four of them. But there is a nasty surprise at the end, as you can see here. We're snaking down underneath the railway viaduct there. And it's a sort of sprint here now. It's difficult to control because of the narrowness of the approach here, right down on the toe of Italy.
A lot of pink jerseys there. Eric Zabel won't be too far away. Zabel riding at the front end. This is the first time, and I can't believe it, Phil, in such a long career, that Eric Zabel is actually riding the Giro d'Italia. He'll be looking for a win.
Well, it'll be another feather in his great career cap if he gets one here, but he's going to have to take on the likes of Pataki, particularly, I think, and also Robbie McEwen. McEwen always comes to this event to try and win a couple of stages and then call it a day and go home. That's bad luck there, because that's a flat tyre for Sandy Cassar. Now, he wouldn't have won the stage, but he wouldn't want to lose time either at this stage of the event. There's McEwen, fourth or fifth wheel.
He's got a teammate up alongside him, but look how precarious it is coming into town. McEwen completely and utterly locked onto the wheel there of Alessandro Patacchi. The golden helmet there, you can just see in the blue and grey jersey, is Paolo Bettini, that golden jersey, to remind everybody that he's the Olympic road racing champion from Athens last year.
And also just behind McEwen, and in fact McEwen chatting with him there, is his teammate and countryman Henk Vogels, trying to sort something out for the sprint perhaps. Good position to be in. You've got to hold front positions now, because this is such a tortuous approach to the line. There's no chance for anybody to move up. The Silver Bullets have got control of this. They could well be taking Pataki to his first stage win on day one of the road races.
Look at this, you don't want to be here at all. This is the back end of the main field. If you're here right now, I think you've got a very good chance of losing yourself 30 or 40 seconds. Still, Pataki's got his men in control. Robbie McEwen banging heads there a few moments ago, but keeping himself right in the position he wants to. He wants to launch himself off the wheel of Alessandro Pataki. But of course, Fassabortolo in complete control at the front end of the main field.
Well, Pataki is the last man of the string of the silver train there just now. Marco Velo is usually his lead-out man. He'll be the last to go for the line before they launch Pataki at it. And, in fact, that's Baden-Cook also mixing up near the front now in the white jersey. There's McEwen just rocking and rolling a little bit to make the space. He wants space.
Watch out there, Zabel moving up as well. This is the kind of sprint that Zabel likes. I would notice there that McEwen has dropped back one or two places there. He's lost it in these few corners. That's usually a bit of a surprise, because McEwen is the man that is very hard to move off the wheel of Alessandro Pataki. Still, it's Fassabortolo on the front end of the main field. We can't be too far away now from the Flamme Rouge, the red kite. About 1.5 kilometres to go, I think.
Yep, just inside as you speak. And in fact, it looked as though Baden-Cook and McEwen were starting to mix it together. They're great sprinting rivals. Remember, they battled out the green jersey in the Tour de France last year. And they've been locking swords for a while. But this is a very interesting approach to the line to the day. I hope they've recce'd the finish, because there is a small climb which will take us up to the line. It shouldn't affect too much the situation. Sorry about that little bit of picture breakup. Back up to the helicopter now. As they come under the Flamme Rouge, it's 1 kilometre to go. This is looking very good for Pataki, but watch out for Zabel. Brilliant, and that's Henk Vogels also moving up on the shoulder of Zabel.
Well, Robbie McEwen lost it a bit there. He's moving around the outside. Look at the man there from Fassa Bortolo. Just pulled off. He'd done his job for Alessandro Patacchi. Down to two men. Brett Lancaster is right up at the front there. He's got a very good chance of keeping his pink jersey. And Paolo Bettini's moving to the front of the pack.
Well done for Brett Lancaster. But Bettini's deciding to try and power this one out. This is a perfect finish for somebody like Bettini. I saw him win a big stage of the Tour de Lancaster in the Cameron Highlands doing just this on a long climb to the line. They're all looking at each other. Well, that's a mistake, because Bettini won't be needing asking twice. You know, this is a man, he may be Olympic champion. He has never won a stage of the Giro d'Italia, and surely that is enough.
That's a good gap at this stage. Baden Cook is right up there in third position. Robbie McEwen slipping away. Cookie, you know, is really riding back to the top end of the sprinting peloton. But Paolo Bettini's got himself about 50 metres here. He's got to give it everything.
Well, hats off to Bettini. I think he's done enough to take this now as he makes this corner up towards the line. The sprinters have handed it to him. The pocket rocket has gone. As he comes up towards the finish, he wears the golden helmet of the Athens Olympic Road Race champion. That in itself was a good victory. This one, I think, will be even sweeter. Even the police are taking photos. Keep your toes in. Paolo Bettini is about to get his first ever victory in a Giro d'Italia. And he's well clear. He'll also get the pink jersey. So it's first all round for the man from Quickstep as he comes up to line. And McEwen somehow has slipped away. Well, McEwen also gets second.
That's amazing, McEwen. In fact, Alessandro Patacchi just held on for third there. I think they were all very much surprised. Look at this again, though. This is the moment where Paolo Bettini decides these guys are slowing down. This is where I've got to go. I'm sure, Phil, he knew more than anybody else what this final kilometre was like, because this was a very brave move to take on the sprinters. And just look how Fassa Bortolo disintegrate.
That was the only way to beat the might of Alessandro Patacchi. His team did everything right for Patacchi, but he didn't control the head of the race and he made his move far too late. There's the face of the winner. He is a winner, Alessandro Bettini, all of the time. Sees his opportunity and takes it.
Well, he's a great champion, and let's not forget this man is a former winner of the World Cup, which doesn't exist anymore, and I wonder if he'll try and get himself some points for the new Pro Tour. But there's confirmation of that result, and a time gap too, 3 seconds back to McEwen.
And that'll be the standing overall too, maybe a little bit more. Patacchi, Cook, all the sprinters, boy, they'll be smarting tonight. Here's the big bottle of champagne. This is the race, remember, nobody can open the champagne. I think they try to use the same bottle every night. Here we go again. He's better than most. Well, little Paolo, he gets what is in effect his 44th win of his career, his first of the season, his first ever pink jersey, his first ever Giro stage win. And overall, McEwen second at 12 seconds.
Yeah, but look, not too far down. Paolo Savoldelli riding well for Discovery Channel. But this man, I think, today, what a great day for him. First stage victory and, of course, the Maglia Rosa as well, with a 12-second advantage over McEwen and Patacchi. That's a precarious lead.
Stage two of the Giro d'Italia, as we move on now, as we begin our journey a little bit up the towards the heel of Italy, away from the toe, and a little bit of undulations today, but nothing that should upset the rhythm of the sprinters. We stay down on this beautiful coastline here. This is the southwestern coastline of the base of Italy, right on the sole in effect, as we race along here, and then head up towards Catanzaro Lido. And onward we go. This is an interesting stage, but it will stay very hot. I think the heat is more concerning than the mountains today. The road down here normally, a very good surface, and the racing usually very quick.
Difficult thing for the riders in conditions like this is the heat. Now we're looking now as you can see Eric Zabel moving up to the front, 219, riding the Giro d'Italia, and claiming to enjoy the Giro d'Italia here for the first time in his career. Big organisation on the front end of the main field. They are completely and utterly all over the road, and look at the field here as we look at the Testa della Corsa, the front end of the bike race. The speeds are phenomenal.
Well, having made a big mess of it yesterday, Patacchi will be out for revenge for day today, I would think, because these early flat stages are the ones he wants to score in. This is a fairly tough Giro, but most of it happens in the last 10 days of the race. Basically, we've got five mountain stages and three average mountain stages, but there are officially 10 flat stages.
Bettini on the left-hand side in the pink jersey, locked there onto the wheel of Alessandro Patacchi, who's got five of his teammates up alongside him, leading out the sprint. can see one or two riders in the pink jerseys of T-Mobile. Eric Zabel over to the right-hand side there. He's looking good. He's getting himself. There's going to be a big battle here once again for Alessandro Patacchi's wheel. He's the man who last year was completely and utterly dominant in the sprint. But this year he still has to open up his bank account.
Oh, the wind there for the Italian flag is keeping the riders pinned to the right of our picture. It's coming in off the sea, and it's a very warm wind indeed. King of the Mountains wearer, by the way. It's a green jersey too here in the Giro, is Venneberg. Got off to a good start yesterday with his one small third category climb win. And Sven Kraus is the early leader in the Inter-Giro. One rider giving up yesterday, the only man, Didier Roos, former champion of France.
Looks like Cookie moving up to the front there. But it's still under control of Fassa Bortolo. Four riders. Look at the little arms flicking there. That was an indication that there was a barrier coming up. They're hugging the barrier there on the right-hand side. And you can see they're trying to keep themselves organized. They're down to three men now in front of Alessandro Patacchi. Eric Zabel not very happy getting himself boxed in. There's a lot of fighting going on here. Paolo Bettini's trying to take at the front end of the main field. And it looks as if Panaria Phil are now starting to get themselves organized in this.
Well, that's interesting. Brett Lancaster, having lost his lead after that brief win in the prologue, and probably the shortest ever lead of the tour, come to think of it, just 1 kilometre yesterday, or 2 days ago rather, now 1 kilometre to the finish here. Now Patacchi again is getting the big lead out he wants here. Tezzato, Velo are all the men who are trying to lead him out, but Baden-Cook is feeling a bit better because he's the first man best of the rest. There's a sudden rush too from Crédit Agricole, and even the Giro's pink jerseyed leader there trying to get in on the act as well. In fact, that was Sven Kraus, because that's the Ciclamino jersey.
Well, Fassa Bortolo have completely and utterly lost it here. They've been swamped out right in the middle there. You can see the Ciclamino jersey trying to get himself online, but they really are setting themselves up for a sprint.
I said that was Kraus. In fact, it's McEwen who's pulled on as second place in the points competition after his second place yesterday, and he's very, very close to the sprints that matter here now. And in fact, McEwen again is getting the better of Patacchi, I think, because this is Robbie McEwen, and it's going to be an early birthday party because McEwen gets the stage win in the Giro d'Italia. That's why he came here, the Australian again winning a stage of the Giro.
Well, I don't know what went wrong with Alessandro Patacchi there. The team had a great lead out with about 1.5 kilometres to go. As they hit the Flamme Rouge, it was complete and utter disorganisation. There's McEwen in the Ciclamina, nicely placed, but look on the right-hand side. It looks as if it's panic on board the Fassa Bortolo flagship here because they've lost control of the front end of the main field. There's Patacchi on the right, but at this point he's boxed in right up against the barriers with nowhere to get out.
Well, the Crédit Agricole rider clashing there was, in fact, Jan Kersipu. But and it's Kersipu's making the move now onto the right here. And it was a bit of a squeeze through there. I don't know how Cookie got through there, but Patacchi says, I'm out of this one.
There you can see Robbie McEwen holding back, calm and collected, the big poker player. He knows he's got the acceleration. He's right on the wheel there of Kersipu, sees the door opening. Now's the moment to lunge. Opens up the gap, and he's actually pulling away over the last 30 or 40 metres from everybody just before the line. Looks under his elbows to see there's no one there. Gets his chance of victory, put the arms up in a victory salute.
So win number one for him this year at least. He always manages to pull off a win in the Giro d'Italia. He lasts about 10 days as a rule, Robbie McEwen, and then he goes and gets ready for the Tour de France, which is still to come, of course. But that's a great finish for him, and that will give him an outright lead in that Ciclamino points jersey competition, I would have thought, at the moment.
Well, he's had a great start to the season, but I tell you what, he got himself the win there just ahead of Isaac Galvez and Robert Forster of Gerolstein, and looking pretty good, and Patacchi Phil could only manage fourth.
It's a bit interesting, that result. Robert Forster finally getting his crack at a big tour here. He's a very fast finisher, as a rule, in smaller races, but all smiles to the champion of Australia. Second time he's worn that jersey as champion. And it was Sue O'Grady, his arch rival last year. There's confirmation then. And Galvez and Foster, a little bit of a surprise, but good places for them on second and third. Overall, McEwen's also got the pink jersey. Becomes only the fourth Australian to wear that. 8 seconds ahead of Bettini. Patacchi is third. All the sprinters enjoying life at the moment. It'll all change in about 3 weeks' time.
An incredible sprinter, Robbie McEwen. The amazing thing to me, Phil, is whenever Robbie comes to the front in the sprints, he seems to have to spend the last couple of kilometres completely on his own. But he says he enjoys that kind of sprinting. He likes to look after himself. He's a solo artist.
Well, he's got to wear that jersey tomorrow on a 210-kilometre stage. So the long journey starts now as we begin the climb up the Italian peninsula. We'll stay on the western side with a stage of 210 kilometres and a field almost intact. As the riders now think about another hot day in the saddle. No change in the mountains yesterday, there weren't any mountains. Venneberg and Kraus is hanging on to his lead in the Inter-Giro competition.
Well, the Ciclamina jersey on the shoulders of Alessandro Patacchi.
Rightfully owned, though, by McEwen, Paul, after his win yesterday.
Too warm to wear two jerseys down here. Paolo Bettini, the wearer of the first pink jersey on the open roads of the Giro d'Italia, and a man, I think, this year looking to try and get himself back into the lead if he can.
I must say, it's always nice to get three different leaders in 3 days of racing off to a good start.
There's Danilo De Luca. This is the team we expect to see a lot more of when we get up into the big mountains. This is Giovanni Lombardi of Team CSC. And, of course, Paolo Savoldelli here riding for Discovery Channel. I think very happy. He actually made an agreement with the team to ride the Giro d'Italia and then work for Lance Armstrong later in the season at the Tour de France. But Robbie McEwen, well, as always, a very popular man here in Italy.
He's a popular man wherever he rides, the sprinter, but he's got to keep his attention focused today as we move away here from Diamante to Gifoni Valpiana. It'll take us up to 600 kilometres covered already in this year's Giro d'Italia. Little bit of undulations just to keep the old legs loose. Most of the undulations are out in the beginning, and then we drop down not much above sea level before the finishing line. So if they can keep control, but 200 kilometres plus means a 5.5 hour day today, again in hot conditions, and the undulations coming near the end might prove decisive.
In fact, it's Licky Gas in control at the front end of the main field here, and I wonder if Stefano Garzelli thinks he's got a chance of staking the victory this afternoon. And of course, let's not forget Danilo De Luca has been very present. That was Danilo De Luca in third place there in the white jersey, but as you can see, it's absolutely chaos at the back end of the main field because of the pressure of these slight undulations towards the end.
Well, Italy is such a beautiful country, and none more so than right down here where the weather's almost guaranteed to be excellent as well. And it looks as though Leaky Gas are taking a real interest on today's stage. Garzelli, remember, he won this race back in 2000. He's one of the big Italian superstars when it comes to any Giro d'Italia.
Yeah, but they're looking for Danilo De Luca this afternoon. That's De Luca in third place there in the white jersey, the leader of the new Pro Tour, Testa della Corsa, the front end of the bike race. Not too many riders here from Alessandro Patacchi's team this afternoon. I think it's just been a little bit too hard for the sprinters on the running down towards the finishing line. The lime green jerseys at the front, you can see also moving up to the front, Gilberto Simoni in about 10th or 12th position there in the Lampre jersey. Also up at the front in about 11th or 12th position was Paolo Savoldelli, keeping himself very attentive as well.
They might well have confidence in not being an absolute pure sprinter's finish today.
In fact, there's been a big split here.
There has.
There's a huge split here on the run in towards the finish. That was on a small climb just a few kilometres ago, and it really has caused some unrest for the sprinters.
Just trying to see if I can see if the Maglia Rosa is in there, of Robin McEwen, because he doesn't normally miss out on a situation like this. Small climbs don't hurt him at all.
That's Gioni on the front, Danilo De Luca moving up into second place, and also Paolo Bettini could be looking here, Phil, to get
line.
Himself back into the pink jersey here this afternoon, because I have a feeling, looking back down that long line of riders, there are not any sprinters left in this group.
Well, the split has come on pure speed here. As you can see, we're into the last 2 kilometres of racing. Well, De Luca, has he kept his form from the Spring Classics? He won the Amstel Gold Race and Flèche Wallonne in a great flurry of activity. The field now try to regroup here a little bit, and I don't see the pink jersey down there at the moment at all, so McEwen may have missed out here.
There's going to be a change in the overall classification this afternoon, and I would say it's got to go to Paolo Bettini, but you know, Danilo De Luca is trying to get his men all over the front end of this main field. They are putting an unbelievable pressure on this group. They're inside the last 1.5 kilometres to go, and again, it's a very tricky and precarious running towards the line. Look at De Luca there, looking over his shoulder. Paolo Bettini's up into fourth place. A little bit further back is Paolo Savoldelli there, Phil, in around about 7th or 8th place, and we're now going inside the red kite, 1 kilometre to go.
So, as we're racing now up towards the line here, there is a little undulation. This is not a totally flat man sprint, but as you can see, the field has got themselves together, and De Luca is still getting the lead out, and Patacchi and the boys are not in on this one, and neither is Robin McEwen. De Luca isn't going to go through on his teammate just yet because he's waiting for the perfect launch. Watch out for the man in the golden helmet, though. Perfectly positioned. Quick calculation tells us he'll be the next leader. Return to the pink jersey for Bettini. Can he do it in style as they start to fan out here now? Look at the face of De Luca. This is his best chance yet. His teammate takes him wide. Bettini's got the second wheel as they line up for the finish. And this should be a win for De Luca, but they're closing in on him. He's looked over to check the situation. How has he got a second kick in him? Because Bettini has. Bettini's been forced wide. De Luca trying to hold the line. He's got it. Now it's going to be neck and neck. And he's kept Bettini a bit tight on the barriers there. But it looks as though he's going to come clear. And this is going to be a win for Danilo De Luca. He's seen the finish and a return to the top for him. He gets the stage. But Bettini, who's about fifth or sixth over the line, he'll get the pink.
I tell you what, that was a dodgy run in towards the finish. There's a lot of changes of directions, and that's what kept Danilo De Luca on the front end of that group. I have a feeling the man who was coming up alongside him in second place was Damiano Cunego, but this is the damage that's been done. There's Stuart O'Grady over on the left-hand side, Baden Cook, Eric Zabel. This is the group with all the sprinters, and they were caught out on the run in towards the line because of the slight incline and, of course, the speed, I think, which those men at the front went over those small hills.
Yes, they'll be unhappy again. Sprinter's day out spoiled by the strong men of the Giro d'Italia splitting up on that small hill before the running. And a minute almost going by here, which means they're not going to see pink again. The likes of McEwen also will see that jersey go across to the all-rounder, Paolo Bettini. Well, I think Pataki might try and clean up here simply because it's points in the bag, although there won't be any points because that was quite a big group, wasn't it?
It was a big group of around about 35 riders, so there shouldn't really be any points left around for the Ciclamina competition. There was Robbie McEwen as well, so all the big sprinters really got caught out by that split on the run in towards the finish. But Phil, look at this one more time. Paolo Bettini tries to get around there, but unfortunately, as always in the Giro d'Italia, there are some dodgy run-ins towards the finish, and Bettini smashed straight against the barrier. That's Cunego coming up alongside, trying to get into the slipstream, and Daniel Cunego is trying to wait till the last possible moment. But De Luca, well, he really is this season a man on fire. I think he's right back to the top of the form he had a couple of seasons ago.
There's Damiano there getting second, showing us perhaps he is ready to defend his title as we move on up the road. Still an awful long way to go. As we've
only done about 500. I doubt that. He said he's going to work for Gilberto Simoni this year.
Right.
He said it in all the press readings that I saw before the start.
Time will tell. Arch rivals on the same team. Who is the leader? We don't yet know.
That's tough.
Danilo De Luca there. Very cool sprint that was, and very confident indeed. And there they are, the best men getting all the same time. It was Garzelli in third place, Celestino in fourth, Ventoso Alberdi in fifth, and Bettini was in the end in sixth. Christoph Moreni there getting placed as well. Here we go with the champagne session again, but De Luca now has got the stage win, while Bettini should be on board with the overall race lead. In the mountains competition, McEwen should keep his lead in the points, but Cioni has gone ahead in the mountains and Kraus has kept his lead in the Intergiro, and that's the confirmation. 9 seconds for De Luca, 17 to Cunego, and 23. Big threat there, Garzelli. He'll be very pleased with his first 4 days of racing.
I wonder if this man thought at the start of the day he was going to get himself back into the Maglia Rossa. It's been a great start to the Giro d'Italia for Paolo Bettini. He's a very good bike rider.
...596.5 kilometres under the wheel so far. We move on now from the Grifoni Valle Piano, heading up to Frosinone. And this is almost 200 kilometres again. But this probably the flattest day so far. So the sprinters should keep control of this one. They're smarting a bit after losing more than a minute yesterday, and all hopes now of another bite of the pink jersey cherry. This road pretty flat today as we continue to go north up the leg of Italy.
Again, it's been a very difficult run in towards the finish. 5 kilometres to go. You can see everybody's all over the road. I think we've had another slight split on the run in towards the finish line. You can see that there are no team cars behind. That split happened just a few moments ago. They're starting to bring the team cars forward. Looking down there to see if Paolo Bettini's made the split here this afternoon. There's a lot of orange jerseys there. And you can see, I think the guys from Lamprey here, Phil, are really starting to get this one sorted out. They're feeling now that their man Damiano Cunego's got a very good chance. There's Robbie McEwen there in the Peter Klemina jersey. Andrea Tonti on the front end of the group. But Robbie McEwen, in fact, has made the split here this afternoon when a lot of other riders have disappeared from the front of this group.
Well, since the race began officially, the distance has shot up to over 200 kilometres. That's often a case with the Giro, to tell you. You're never too sure what they finish up with. But they're saying that this stage will run out at about 210 kilometres. So it's been a long day today and it wasn't planned. As the riders now race up towards the last line, and Pataki again, his team seems to be organised, but Alessandro is having a big difficulty finishing it off. There's Bettini, looking good in pink. He's been very strong this week.
He's been very strong. Stefano Garzelli just on the far side, up alongside him. But Robbie McEwen has got all of the boys on the front end. This is Björn Lukemans trying to keep the pace nice and high for McEwen. They're trying to set this one up for Robbie. Robbie's there in fourth position, and as always, they really are dodgy run-ins to the finish line here at the Giro d'Italia. You can see one or two riders. There's Pataki nice and happily alongside his teammate, but his team, Phil, have not got control. And I wonder if that's an indicator that Pataki's not in good form this afternoon.
Well, Frosinone is, like many places in Italy, built on top of a little hill, and there's the evidence of it, as they now are going to have to keep the pressure on and climb steadily towards the line. I think this might upset the sprinters again here. And that's an attack that's gone off there from one of the Euskadel team riders here, which is an interesting move, I must say.
Well, that was Aito Gonzalez.
But surely not.
Yep, it's Aito Gonzalez going off the front. This is a man who...
Time trial expert, watch out.
We haven't seen him ride well for the last couple of seasons. Now, that is a very nicely timed move, and he's caught the team of Lotto Devitamon very much off guard there. This is the kind of move that could pay.
Just look at the gear he's pushing here on his big ring. Well, it's a difficult finish, but he may have caught them. He's taking a tip out of Bettini's book of day two. On stage one.
Lotto there. But what do I do, Robbie? What do I do? Just put your head down, go for it, because it's still a couple of kilometres to go to the finish. Gonzalez, I think, Phil, starting the renaissance. Now it's Paolo Bettini said, we're not having that. Don't give time to a man like Aito Gonzalez, because we could lose out.
Well, Bettini making the move there, and the rider behind him is Emmanuel Seller. And if his name sounds familiar, he made his name in this race last year with a great stage win. He's one of the young up-and-coming riders. He's a good climber. He's not a sprinter. But this is turning out not to be a sprint finish. And Aito Gonzalez is hanging on here. And this would be a big result for him. But the field are getting themselves organised.
Well, it's good to see Aito Gonzalez here coming back. These streets are very narrow indeed. And I think right now the lactic acid is starting to build up in those legs of Aito Gonzalez. The Italians are all over the front end of the main field. And as you can see, they're onto his tail. It's all over from Gonzalez. But don't discount this man, Phil, later on in the tour.
Well, that was a good move by Gonzalez. He sent the message out that he's got some good legs here. That's still Seller trying to come up on him. But I'm afraid he's got the whole field behind him, and he's got the biggest danger man in this opening week. Paolo Bettini is not going to give up that pink jersey without a fight.
And Garzelli not very far away either, trying to keep himself in with a chance. Moving up there is the leader of the King of the Mountains classification. That's like Verbrugge there.
There should be Daniel Cioni in that jersey now as he comes up towards the line under the trees, and he's got the lead. It is Daniel Cioni, who's up to seventh overall. He's had a good start as well to the opening week of the Giro d'Italia. It's hard to find the riders in these high-rise buildings down here in the centre of the finishing town of Frosinone. Now a little bit of a kick down. Boy, these are technical approaches. Look at this horseshoe.
This is very carefully taken by all of the riders at the front end of the group. But you know, there is no organisation in this main field. There is Bettini. He is riding like he's a man possessed. He wants to keep that Maglia Rosa if he can. Cioni's up into seventh place in the overall classification. Watch out for him. Let's just see how they got around that corner. I think you can see Seller took it just a little bit too wide.
Well, Cioni made the split yesterday, and that gave him also the lead in the King of the Mountains competition over Venneberg, Tornwald Venneberg, the Dutchman. Bit of a newcomer on the scene this season. But this long little drag is rather annoying to some of these riders now, because again they're being caught out. Strong men will out here.
Well,
they split the field. There'll be time gaps if they keep this pressure on now. I think the pink jersey's in there somewhere. He just dipped off our camera to the bottom.
Second place. Bettini looking comfortable, following them round, but this is a really nasty downhill into the finish line. They're really going to have to take risks to try and stay in contact with this group. The sprinters a few moments ago looked as if they were going to have everything going their way, but look at how much of the road field they are using. There's the Flamme Rouge. This is a downhill finish in the Ultimo Kilometro.
And it may not be downhill all the way to the line, but there will be a timed gap if they keep this pressure on now, because this gap opened quite a way out, and Bettini is poised with Gioni.
Cook is there in third place. Baden Cook has made the best move of all the sprinters. He's right there in third position onto the wheel of Paolo Bettini. This could be a great win for Baden Cook.
Well, the line out has started and Cookie's got third wheel, and there's five or six riders clear of the field. They will get a separate time as the riders are signalling to leave the course. And there will be separate times here now, and the pink jersey has made it absolutely to perfection. Is this Cunego again, and a little bit of a time trial, realising danger perhaps. He's trying to bridge at 400 metres, can you believe? As Cioni's going to be taken on by Cook here, Bettini's leading out Cook. Now that might be the wrong thing to do. That's Mazzanti, I think, in the Panaria jersey, as he too is trying to come away, Luca Mazzanti. But it looks as though this might be a win. Oh, and dear me, well, Bettini moved over there for my money, and that's cut down. Bettini wins, and Mazzanti is second. But if I was the referee, I think I'd be looking to relegate Bettini for that. We might see it again.
I think they will be looking at that very seriously. Uh-oh. Cookie is not happy at all. He was in the ideal position. This man could have burst off the wheel of Bettini.
That was a win.
Let's just have a look at it one more time. Cookie's already been down once. If you look at his knee, there is already blood there. Bettini moves across his line there, pushes Cookie, and Cookie at this point has lost it straight into the barriers. He's gone down very hard, and that's a shame, Phil, because his form this year was starting to reflect the form he had a couple of years ago when he was the winner of the green jersey points classification in the Tour de France.
Well, the question the judges will ask, did Bettini do it on purpose, or did he move off his straight sprinting line? If he did, then Baden-Cook won't get the win because he didn't. Well, you're a brave man, Paolo, going and apologising to Baden Cook, who has a bit of a fiery temper. He's going back to have another go at him.
I don't think you want to be lip-reading what Cookie's saying at the moment right now, because it won't be very complimentary.
Yeah, no, they're blaming Baden. Well, they would, wouldn't they? But what will the referees do about that? Baden Cook, that's what he's going. He's heading straight to protest. Bettini believes he's won it. He doesn't know he was there. He's shaking his head, he's saying. We might get another look at that. He's gone into the compound to get another pink jersey. Has he got the stage win?
He starts there right along the white line. You see Cookie perfectly lodged behind him. Cookie now starting to dig deep. This is the moment he starts to accelerate. Already Bettini's moving across the left-hand side.
Which is okay at this moment because he's a length clear of Cook. Now he's got to stay straight. And as Cook has taken the inside, I think Cookie overcooked a little bit as well. But in all fairness, Bettini did move to the left and off his line, and the referees, when they see that, I think they'll relegate him to the back of that leading group. But unfortunately, that means they'll award the win to the second place finisher, and that's the rider in orange here, Luca Mazzanti, and that'll be his first win in the Giro d'Italia if that's the case. Now let's see.
There's the discussion. This is the discussion. Paolo Bettini not very happy, but that's one of the referees saying, I'm sorry, you did move off your line. We've looked at the video footage, and we can see that you move at least 50% away from the centre of the road.
So, in Italy, the Italians don't usually get relegated. There's another Italian winner anyway, and he's gone. Bettini relegated the back of the group, and it was only in fourth place, so he'll keep pink. Same time, and although the man isn't there, Baden Cook, he will get the same time as the winner, but of course you get the position where you get up and cross the line, so no prize when he looked like he might have won the stage. There's the winner though, Luca Mazzanti gets his first ever stage win, and he looks a little bit surprised.
Well, Cookie won't be too worried about the time. He's very worried about the way he went down there. He went down exceptionally hard, and he's a man I thought was threatening to win. And of course Bettini does keep the overall lead with 13 seconds now ahead of Danilo De Luca.
Zanti keeping the good fortune of Panaria in this opening week after the victory on day number one.
Look at this, he's not
no
happy.
No champagne.
Not happy at all with that, Phil.
He might well have to be persuaded to come out on stage five. Let's find out. Well, as we face up now to 223 kilometres here, as we leave Celano, head to La Quia. A couple of climbs on the way today. That should stretch the legs of the climbers at the moment. Dario Cioni has the green jersey as King of the Mountain. Sven Kraus still holds the blue as the Intergiro winner. Bettini, despite being relegated from first to fourth, has become the next leader in the Ciclamino points competition, and he also keeps his Maglia Rosa as well. So there's Sven Kraus. He's in the blue. As now we get ready Big conversation, of course, but he's back and he's going to ride. So Paolo Bettini has recovered from his little bit of a spit overnight. I think when he looks at the pictures, he's got to be realistic. He did move off his line, although I don't think he intentionally meant to bring down Badenkirk.
Well, no rider intentionally tries to do it. Eric Zabel looking very happy, enjoying the sunshine. 5 kilometres to go here. Well, this is rather an interesting move. It's been a very difficult day. One or two riders have been caught out by the severity of the course, but they're trying to get themselves organised at the front end of the peloton.
Well, it's been a difficult day. It's been a day of changes too, because Rujano has got himself the lead in the King of the Mountains competition day. He's been scoring well out on the course. These are the four riders in the lead now. Petrov, Ivan Parra out in front. Koldo Gil has also been riding well. Having a pretty good season, Koldo Gil, this year.
This is Ivan Parra. They reckon Parra is going to be a serious contender for the future, but this breakaway is about to go back into the fold, although somebody on the right-hand side there has decided, I'll just try one out of the handbook. I'll try one more time and see if I can just shake off and survive off the front end of this main group. This is Parra.
Yeah, it's Parra gone for it, and he knows that it's all coming back together. He's the leader of the Sella Italia team, a team which has a couple of very good Australians on it this year, Trent Wilson, Russell Van Howell. Not just this year, they were also good Australians in this race last year. They've been looking forward to the Giro, and it was Trent Wilson, the last man to get the nod to ride the event, and in fact he finished last in the prologue to give us a total Australian sandwich, with Brett Lancaster winning, of course, 4 days ago.
So CSC taking control at the front end of the group, in fact doing a fair bit of the work there for Ivan Basso. 4 kilometres to go. Basso now has claimed he's going to win the Giro d'Italia this year. There's Andrea Pirron up there into second place. A little bit further back, a lot of riders in this group from Discovery Channel looking rather good.
Well, it's been a test day for the riders this day, a chance to get the feel of the mountains, although it's still some 4 or 5 days away to the big ones. De Luca, Laquia, well, he's heading towards his home. In fact, he doesn't live too far away, and he's down there in the white jersey. He's pulled on the jersey again as leader of the Pro Tour, although not too many people know much about that.
They don't at the moment. There's the leader of the Giro d'Italia, though, in the pink, Paolo Bettini, moving up through the middle. He's a very agile bike rider onto the wheel now of Danilo De Luca. Discovery Channel, maybe they're trying to sort something out for Paolo Savoldelli, who is riding exceptionally this year, but it's still Team CSC on the front end of the group. Looking comfortable, nice and organised here. There's a little bit disorganised on the right-hand side, though, as one or two teams are trying to get themselves into a formation to set themselves up for the sprint.
Well, 3 kilometres to go. There's about 60 riders here. That's all in this peloton. It's been split up again on the running. The men in contention are here. No one, to our knowledge, has been left behind today, because for many of the big leaders, the Giro is hardly about winning right now. It's just about making sure you don't miss any moves and throw away silly time. And it's working out well for all the likely contenders. Big favourite, Ivan Basso, is here, and for some reason he's told his team to drive today towards the finish. It is a climb up to the line.
Just looking at a couple of heart rate monitors here, Charlie Wagelis has a maximum heart rate of 194, and he's currently only working at 72% of his maximum there with 140. Gives you an idea that actually in this group, if you're sitting in the wheels, it's not all that hard. But that's for the men who've survived the climbs we've been over this afternoon. There have been rather a number. It hasn't had a major effect, but it certainly put one or two riders in difficulty.
Well, I'll tell you what, this race was officially 215 kilometres again. It's been added up to 223 today. Another long day, and they're going to be in the saddle for about 6 hours. So it's been a tough opening leg to the Giro. We're going through the 1,000-kilometre point on this, the fifth stage and the sixth day of the race, as they're now lining up for the sprint. And, well, I'm just wondering if they're trying to get Basso or maybe Giovanni Lombardi over the line first here.
I might be thinking about that. It's Rabobank now trying to get themselves organised, moving up to the front end. Very high pace here as we charge into the final couple of kilometres. It's going to be a precarious run into the finish, though.
Well, the rider who seems to be making up most of the work here is Roy Sentjens from the Netherlands. This is his first Giro d'Italia. I don't quite know why he's driving so hard, because he's got no team with him. At 1,300 metres, I think that sign was, and still Sentjens setting the pace here. Big, tall, lanky Dutchman.
It's Kolobnev in second place. He's a Russian national champion. But you see, they're being swamped completely and utterly. They'd set the pace there for about a kilometre or so. Then all of a sudden, they just popped DeLuca's up into second place, looking comfortable.
And the Leaky Gas boys have been given the nod here. Well, DeLuca has had one win already this week, and he's now in a very strong position here. And I would figure that Eric Zabel might be in the mix somewhere here as well. Last kilometre. And a change, a Sonia Duval rider having a dig.
Well, they're going to try and take this one out if they can, but you can see in about fourth position there, Danilo De Luca looking pretty good. They're looking to see what they can do. They've been in the saddle this afternoon for almost 6 hours.
Just wondering if that's Juan Manuel Garati who's trying to go away there, but again, a counter-attack coming from T-Mobile. It wasn't Garati, and he sat up and dropped right out of it. And again, a little tight uphill finish towards the line, spoiled what sprinters' chances there are here. There aren't that many sprinters here. It's a perfect finish again for De Luca as he brings the line to. There's Bettini, perfect finish for him as well. And Cioni is also here. He may have lost his lead in the King of the Mountains, but he's riding a very good race.
He's Kessler on the front, followed by Kolobnev, followed by De Luca. But look at that, Ivan Basso looking so comfortable there in fourth place.
Basso riding very well there, and again, all of these riders not losing a single second in the overall classification, and Bettini also trying to get in on the action. Just watching out. Kessler still holding control here, but De Luca is going over the top. How many times have we seen him finish like this? Remember Flesh Wallon when he came away there and won straight up the hill in the Mur de Huy? And now he's going to have to chase because somebody's gone there for Pataki's team. It's not Pataki.
It's Brusagin, I think, who's gone. And Maurizio Brusagin has been given a bit of freedom this afternoon. He's got himself a gap, but right on his wheel there is Danilo De Luca.
Well, this has been a big effort by Maurizio Brusagin. And is he going to hold off? I don't think he is, because De Luca is on fire this week. Now, this 20-second bonus will give him pink, I think. As he hits the line, he gets his second win of the week. And I think that was the worst possible result for Paolo Bettini, because 20 seconds should be enough.
Well, look at this. He was right on the wheel. That's Brusagin, who took the risk of trying to go out for a long way, but he actually set this sprint up for Danilo De Luca. Danilo De Luca at this point got no chance at all of being beaten. This man has had a most wonderful season so far, and I think you're right, that 20-second time bonus is going to give him the double bonus here this afternoon, because he should get the pink jersey as well.
Well, we'll find out when the judges do all the calculations. The face there of Brusagin over to the left of our picture.
Maybe more dangerous there, right in the middle in the CSC jersey, is Ivan Basso, who was riding high. He wants to win the Giro d'Italia this year. I think he's come with the idea of winning the Giro d'Italia because he feels that he can't challenge Lance Armstrong later on this year in his final attempt at winning the Tour de France.
Well, the wiseness of that decision is all ahead of us, both here and in July, of course, with the Tour de France. But there's the result, just over 6 hours indeed. Brusagin second. Maurizio Ardila there won the Tour of Britain last year, now riding his first Giro. Very good result. What a sprint for him in third place. The man in white, leader of the Pro Tour, more points in the bag for that. And Danilo De Luca checking the flowers the right way round. Second win. And now we're waiting for confirmation. We believe he's got the Giro d'Italia race lead. Let's find out. Yes, he has. Just 3 seconds. The 20 were vital. Second, he wouldn't have done it. Paolo Bettini gets down to second place. Mazzanti stays third. Cioni holds fourth. And Cunego, last year's winner, is in fifth place, enjoying his first week.
Enjoying the first week. I tell you, one man who was up in the top 10 there as well, Paolo Savoldelli from Team Discovery Channel, riding well. But this man, I think, has had a magical season so far this year, and that's what he's looking forward to.
So the race moves on as we continue our journey north up the western side. We flipped over to the east to L'Aquila. Now we're going back over onto the other side as we continue our journey towards Grosseto. And having had a couple of mountains, it's not so hilly today on this sixth stage as we make our way. And I'm amazed to say that we've not had a win yet by Alessandro Pataki after his brilliant race last year. He hasn't found his sprinting legs at all.
I think it may well be because of the little break he had just before the Giro d'Italia. Now, this is the run-in towards the finish, and we can see now it's T-Mobile trying to get themselves sorted out for Eric Zabel. Eric Zabel has been one of my heroes of the sport over the last few seasons. He's a man who's capable of being competitive from February right the way through until October. You know, Phil, in the sport these days, that very rarely happens.
Well, it's a very good finish here. Matthias Kessler, we saw him stretching his legs up the hill yesterday. He's riding pretty well now. He's settling in here, but this would be more to lead out, I would think, Eric Zabel. We're racing down to the marina here in the finishing town of Grassetto. Should be a nice finish for the sprinters. No nasty little hill to knock them all off the front. And look at the scurrying up the line now by the boys from Fassa Bortolo. And just making ground there was, in fact, Bruce Eugene himself that's got the lead now. So clearly he's in the driving seat at the moment to try and put Pataki in the winning one.
What's amazing about this team is, despite the fact Alessandro Pataki hasn't come up with the goods so far, they will always go to the front because they know because of this man's organisational skills, he's got a very good chance of taking out the win, leading themselves around the corner there. And somebody's gone down. There's two riders gone down from Fassa Bortolo.
They overshot the corner.
Well, they were the first men into the corner. There's no way they should. Look at that chaos
on board.
Bruce
was one.
Well, they've come completely and utterly down. They've lost it. Bruce Eugene, 103.
Tassato's the other one. He was the third man getting up. They all, the lead-out men, have taken them clean off the course here. And that is Ongarato. He's another valuable firepower. Well, I don't know if we get to see that again, Paul, but they went into the corner just too quickly.
Just too quickly. They were organised. They were the first men. They had the line around
that
corner. They were nicely organised. I wasn't sure whether or not Alessandro Pataki was able to stay upright. In fact, there's a couple of Fassa Bortolo riders still up there, but that was complete and utter chaos for a moment.
Well, I tell you, that has blown it. I think that's Madame Pataki there wondering what's happened to her husband, because he's still here, I think. Is that him in third wheel?
Just having a look. It's difficult
to
see going through the trees.
It's hard to tell, but his team just thought they had control of that race and took it into that right-hand bend too quick, and they all went out. No, this is Pataki, isn't it? Yes, it is.
Yep, this is Pataki.
So he went down.
He must have gone down, caught out by the confusion there of his teammates, and that really is a blow because they were just getting themselves organised.
Well, some you win and some you lose, and this one, Paul Alessandro Pataki, his bad tour continues. Robbie McEwen hasn't missed out. Now, there's a bike handler for you. You've seen him dice with Mario Cipollini in the rain in the past and profit by it. Now the champion of Australia again trying to get control for another win.
Eric Zabel's there too. He didn't get involved in that crash at all. Alessandro Pataki would be kicking himself. Davita Monlotto completely dedicated here to just one thing, and that's Robbie McEwen. McEwen moving himself up there into third place. Moving up into fourth place. There you can see Eric Zabel. Stuart O'Grady not too far away either.
Well, this is a good ride now by Davita Monlotto. That was Nick Gates who was pile-driving through. The other Aussie on the team at four, of course, Robbie McEwen, along with Henk Vogels. Three Australians make the split there. And now knowing this is a big chance for the team, and a chance that very rarely presents itself, with the top sprinter down and out and riding behind the race. Zabel will be thinking the same. He's sitting on McEwen's wheel, and this could be a big dice between the two of them.
Jan Kersipu up into about fifth position as well. You can see the lead-out men starting to swing across. This has been a very precarious run-in once again, round that corner nice and safely. Davita Monlotta, this looks like it might be Henk Vogels, has got himself a bit of a move off the front.
Well, I think we'd all love Henk to win the stage, even though it might upset Robbie a little bit, although the best of friends. Henk is back in the big time after a terrible crash in the United States, and that is Vogel for
sure.
Well,
he's gone.
That is a great move. And Robbie will try to back this race off now. He'll do his best to slow it down. He's putting Henk into the last kilometre. Henk looks over his shoulder, won't believe. He's got to give it everything he's got left now. This isn't a lead out for McEwen. This is a win for Vogels if he can hang on.
This is a man who has battled back to find some form here in the sport. He's had some terrible accidents over the last couple of seasons. Somebody is grappling across the front there to try and get themselves onto the wheel there of Henk Vogels. Vogels still holding on. This man has been a great track rider in the past. He's been a brilliant roadman. He's ridden a lot of criteriums in France. And I think all the Aussies are backing off at the front end of the group here, wishing Henk Vogels a victory.
It's going to be tough. It's an awful long way, isn't it? 1,000 metres when you've got the whole field in the Giro d'Italia chasing you down. At 400 to go, he's still there. And still behind. The sprint has not started. This could be the biggest victory of Henk Vogel's life here. He's holding the barriers tight now. The chasing rider was Demi Vakansi, but he's been washed away. And now McEwen is firing in the middle just in case. But Vogels may well have this, and that on his wheel is Jan Kersipuu in the green and white. And Vogels at 25 metres has been taken by his teammate, and he doesn't care. He salutes it as well. I don't think Robbie had a choice. They were coming too quickly. McEwen gets his second win.
If there had been an extra 50 metres, McEwen would have held back, but he could see the writing on the wall. He could see a fading Henk Vogels in front of him, and as the team leader, he had to do the business. He had to make sure that the victory stayed within their camp. What a shame for Henk Vogels, but look at the devastation that crash has caused. There's some serious time gaps here once again. Now Alessandro Patacchi, I would think, is in that group there. No, he's still out on the open road. He's lost himself a minute and 43 seconds so far alongside there Massimo Codol.
Well, there was more than 100 riders in the sprint finish, that's for sure. And I guess when you're a sprinter, and sprinting's your business, if you fall and you lose your chance, you just ride in. There's no danger of elimination. Time doesn't really count. He lives to fight another day. It was almost a day off for the riders, less than 4 hours in the saddle today as they all come home. But Pataki will have words for his team tonight. I'm sure about that. They really took it. Here we are. We can see it again. They took him line astern into the corner. And Tassato went down, Brusagin, and then there's Pataki right in the middle, powered in from behind.
Well, that was complete and utter chaos. I really don't know. I think it was just the narrowness of
the
road.
It was a nasty bend.
This is Henk Vogels holding on to the last 25 metres. It was a great move by Henk. He actually wasn't trying to jump away. He went round a corner a little bit faster than everybody else, and then all of a sudden he had the gap. And once you've got the gap inside the last kilometre, there's only one thing to do, and that's go for it. But look at McEwen. McEwen's backing off and waiting. Now he can see Kersipuu coming up there.
Kersipuu did really well to get out of that mess. You had to get round Vogels.
Well, this is the moment that Robbie Vogels, McEwen goes round. Yeah. It was chaotic. McEwen, though, he's on fire in the Giro this year compared to his arch-rival, Alessandro Patacchi, who cannot get anything right. But look at Henk. Looking back, he knows now that his teammate's going to win, but he still keeps powering up to the line.
Well, that's his seventh stage victory in a Tour of Italy since he started coming here. He never gets to the finishing line. He's never had a shot at the final stage in Milano. He always goes home for the Tour de France. But there he is, McEwen on top again. Another win for Australia. They're having a great opening week with three stage wins now. Kersipuu did well to get round Debris and take second place. Big Jan always just misses out on the big victories, doesn't he?
He seems to be a happier man this year since he's moved across to Crédit Agricole, but he doesn't seem to have had the same success or hunger that he had when he rode for AG2R.
Well, there is a new lead as well, Paul, because Bettini did win the Intergiro 3-second time bonus today, and that's given him the lead over Danilo De Luca. 6-second time bonus, I beg your pardon. He's got the lead now by 3. And there he is, back in the pink. Ah, he's forgotten all about his disqualification now, as he's now looking at the pink jersey yet again in this first 7 days of the Giro d'Italia.
Certainly a bit of a ding-dong battle over the first 10 days of racing for that pink jersey.
So here we go. Stage 7, end of the open week, starting of the second full week of racing now as the riders continue their journey. We're going into the nice part of Italy now where many of the top cyclists live as we head up towards Pistoia. This is the base too of many of the Australian riders, including Brett Lancaster here in the Giro d'Italia. So they'll all be trying to notch a win, but the Aussies have got no complaints about this race so far. They've simply had a brilliant start. Of course, small climbs on the way, but the whole area really can have its ups and downs. It's a tough zone. Pistoia, isn't that where Max Chandry come from?
That's where Max Chandry used to live. And the difficult thing about the finish today is there was a rather nasty circuit around. The riders come into Pistoia and then go out into the countryside with a nasty climb, and that could cause one or two rather nasty incidents.
Well, we're looking here. 21 riders have set the scene very early on today, getting away at around about 32 kilometres. At one stage, 12 and three-quarter minutes ahead. And it looks as though Koldo Gill now is trying to hang on. But he's going to keep on going well here, Koldo Gill.
Well, it's not surprising to see such a big group dominate the race this afternoon because we are on the eve of a very important rendezvous, the first big long individual time trial. And this is a very difficult climb here down towards the finish. And you know, Koldo Gill is a rider who over the last couple of years has been promising to do something rather special, and this could be the thing that he's been looking for today.
Well, Gil has done enough now to become the next leader in the King of the Mountain, so a green jersey awaits him. He's never won a stage in the Giro d'Italia, and well can he at 5 kilometres to go. It's a possibility. That was a big breakaway today, but nobody really who mattered was in that leading group. The best place was Americo Celestino, who is 9th overall, 49 seconds off the lead. They've been swept up more or less now. This is the remnants of that escape. But Coldo Gil has been strong all day, and if anything, he deserves the stage win, but that won't be how the riders think.
They won't think like that at all. You can see now a little bit of chaos. These groups have split up over the final few kilometres around Pistoia. It's been a rather undulating day, and finally the riders starting to find a little bit of cool weather. It was very hot in the early part of the Giro d'Italia, with temperatures soaring above 30 degrees Celsius. But today, for the first time, it seems to have dropped down a fraction to around about the 20 degree Celsius mark. And Iban Parra has caught a glimpse there of number 41. He's a rider who has been very attentive over the last couple of days. And this is the front end of the group. You can see Damiano Cunha go there. This is Danilo De Luca. This is a group that's actually managed to get itself off the front end of the main field. There's Paolo Savoldelli.
Celestino's in there too. Just the remnants here, and they're driving on, but it's all coming back together slowly. And Coldo Gil, by the way, has only ever won, actually crossed the line in first place once in his life. He won a stage a couple of years ago in the Tour Rioja. But he has won overall classifications without winning stages. And in fact, he won this year a stage race as well. Now, Simoni is up here right now in this breakaway with De Luca. And this is a useful little move now. They're trying to keep control of it just up until the line.
Trying to keep control of it. They're off the front end of the group, but they will not do it, don't think, anything at all to the advantage of Coldo Gil. And the last time check we got to Coldo Gil, it was around about 2 minutes and 15 seconds. He'll lose a fraction of that on the run-in towards the finish, but he should be able to hold on and get himself the individual stage victory, which I think will probably be one of the biggest wins of his career. But in fact, it's come down dramatically. It's 50 seconds now, Phil, between Coldo Gil and that group of Cunego and Simoni and, of course, Danilo De Luca.
That's not much. Yeah, no, that's why they've crossed the gap to the remnants of the breakaway from the peloton on the climb, and they give it some firepower now, and the boys in the breakaway will probably find it too hard to hang on. But the object now is to get time over Paolo Bettini. We're not sure of where he is just now, as we now drive to line. Looks like he's on the front of this group here. Yes, he is. Gruppo Maglia Rosa. This rider here, though, Coldo Gil, is now trying to get a stage win, which he'll remember forever. This would be by far and away the biggest. Just adjusting his earpiece there. I would imagine the manager, Saez, is going berserk here to try and drive him onto the line.
Absolutely berserk. So the race situation is there's one rider off the front, Coldo Gil. There's a group chasing at 50 seconds, containing, of course, Cunego. As you can see, there's confirmation. And it's a minute 22 seconds back to the group, containing Ivan Basso as well, Phil, so that is a big surprise.
Well, this could be the first serious move of the Giro this year, as they start now to try and get time, but I don't think they're going to catch Coldo Gil. A very, very shaky right-hander there, so it was a good job it wasn't a bunch sprint after what we saw yesterday.
1.4 kilometres to go. He's just got to survive. I don't think the way this man is riding, they're going to pull him back, but he won't have very much when it comes down to the finish line. But again, very difficult to bring these stages of the Giro into these small towns in this part of Italy.
Well, the climb of the Simone is what's decided the race today, and this is where Coldo Gil got maximum points at the top, which has given him the lead in the King of the Mountains. Now he wants to top off a brilliant day of racing. He took a big gamble today. He went away with 21 riders, only 20 miles into the stage, 32 kilometres. He's the only survivor. One or two are still in that chase group behind. And they're not going to catch him now. He can prepare for what will be only his second ever road race win as a pro.
And you see that time gap back to the pink jersey group of Paolo Bettini, 2 minutes and 25 seconds. There's going to be a serious shake-up in the overall classification. I think, if my calculations are correct, we could have either gone down. This is in the group behind, and it looks as if Garzelli has gone down there on the left-hand side.
Wow.
Cioni's up there alongside him, and this is the corner just a few moments ago where we saw Coldo Gil being very, very careful. Now, I think, Phil, it is inside the 3 kilometres to go point, so there shouldn't be any time lost, but Garzelli looked hurt.
I tell you what, he's going to thank this new rule which has come in this year. An instant like that inside 3 kilometres now, not one, will give him the same time as that group he was with. So he will profit by that, because he's about 1.5 from the finishing line there. Meanwhile, up at the finishing line is coming the man about to celebrate. While this has been a big score for some riders in this breakaway, including last year's winner Cunego and Gilberto Simoni, the winner the year before. The two teammates scoring well now. But this rider is going to get his second ever road race win and what will be his fourth ever win as a pro.
Well, time to celebrate there. He looks up. It's going to be a double header for him because, as you said, he's taken the lead in the King of the Mountains classification. Time not that important for him. It's at the front here, Danilo De Luca. And De Luca Hirfield could be putting himself back in the pink jersey.
Well, Danilo De Luca and Bettini are having an incredible tour. Bettini's may have just ended today. But it looks as though Danilo De Luca being outsprinted here by Damiano Cunego. He's an amazing fast finisher, that rider, for such a talent in every other sphere of the sport.
He's a star rider for the future. This is the group of Ivan Basso. Basso has missed out there, Phil. He's in the group, probably lost himself 15 to 20 seconds on the other contenders. Now, that's a big surprise. There he is in about fifth position there, Phil. This is the man who wants to win the Giro d'Italia this year. And that's a big surprise on the eve of the individual time trial.
Well, out today, the sprinter Ivan Caranta. I thought I'd tell you that because we've never seen him the whole week, but he has abandoned the Giro d'Italia today. As we now look at the riders coming in, the clock counting Bettini, out of the pink jersey here, that's for sure. And it looks like he'll be handing it back to Danilo De Luca.
Well, he's not in this group. Darius Baranovski's there for Liberty Seguros, but he is not in this group at all. The Maglia Rosa has still got to come to the finish line. There's Aitor Gonzalez looking very good. He's a possible candidate for the individual time trial tomorrow. And there, just in the distance, is Paolo Bettini.
And fighting.
But look at the clock. A minute and 24 seconds and counting.
Well, Bettini is out of the pink and out of the hunt for the pink, I would think, here now, because with that sprint victory there by Danilo De Luca, second from Cunego, I think they'll be the top two overall. Again, just over 5 hours in the saddle here in Pistoia. Here he comes. Well, he's going down fighting. He's even raced right up to the line. Every second counts. 1 minute 48 he has lost today. And here comes Garzelli and the group now. Well, the good news is the new rule will help, because he will get the same time as the group he was with.
Just look at the way he's holding his fingers there, Phil. I think he's hurt himself quite badly. He went down very hard. He's got a couple of teammates up alongside him. Dario Cioni was with him when he went down there, and I think Cioni is still up there. The other man who's come up alongside to help him out there, you can just see at the back, is Charlie Wigelius, number 159. In fact, it was Charlie Wigelius who was brought onto the team here by Stefano Garzelli. That's Wigelius just over to the right. Not important the time of this man. He will be given the time of the group, Cunego, Danilo De Luca and Gilberto Simoni.
He'll be given the same time, but he won't get the placings, of course. There's the result. Coldo Gil getting his first ever win. Cunego, a very nice second. De Luca third. I think I said De Luca won that, but I got that a bit wrong. De Luca third there. Here's the man who won for Liberty Seguros. They've had a great season, and it continues here now, the Spanish team. And for once, the Italians not getting things entirely their own way in a Giro d'Italia. But they are as far as the race for pink goes, because they've got the top five places overall. And it's back in pink now for Danilo De Luca. And all of these are going to count towards his Pro Tour status as well. He's done pretty well.
What's important for Danilo De Luca is what's coming up tomorrow, though, Phil, the individual time trial.
Yes, and it's 45 kilometres, the race of truth today, as the riders now base themselves for the first big time trial. There's two time trials. We've seen the prologue. That's not included because that's a prologue, only a kilometre. This one, though, will be a big test for Danilo De Luca, who will be the last to start today. And there will not be an easy ride for him. A chance, perhaps, for others to close the gap. Now, it has to be said, Simoni and Cunego, not the best time trialists in the world, could have an interesting result this stage today as we head now down to Florence.
Well, Team CSC have spent a lot of time during the inter-season trying to get themselves into very aerodynamic positions. We're just at the back end of the group here, having a quick look at David Zabriskie. And Zabriskie is one of the most aerodynamic riders in the main field. We can see Zabriskie, in fact, coming in with the best time of 58 minutes and 31 seconds, ahead of Thomas Dekker by a minute and 23
That's
seconds.
Enormous.
That is really going to be the bar to beat, and his teammate, André Piron, up there in third.
And over 3 minutes ahead of the prologue winner, Lancaster. Well, Zabriskie is the national time trial champion of the USA. He's finished. He's waiting now to see what the last man out of the start house can do. Danilo De Luca is off and running.
Well, he's not a great individual time trialist, Danilo De Luca. He'll have to do something very special here this afternoon to keep himself in the Maglia Rossa. Solid full disc wheel at the back. Where's number 151? Been in the saddle for around about 20 seconds. But a little further up the road, this man has not been a great individual time trialist over the last few seasons. But looking at his position here, Phil, I think he's actually changed his position rather dramatically for the individual time trial. Sitting forward on the bike, sorry about the little bit of picture breakup, that's because of the link up to the helicopters and down towards the finishing line. He's on the inside chainring there, that's an indication, which is rather a tough climb.
Well, we expect a good ride from Bouchagine here, and I think we're going to get one too. Vladimir Karpic, who won the white jersey in the Tour de France last year, is on the frame, but Bouchagine has slipped down to second here at the moment. It's a fairly high speed, but this is not seen as a mountain time trial, but it is certainly very hilly. At the moment here, Basso is picking up the tailwind. Zabiski still the best time at the finish. As we now look at the former world time trial champion coming in at kilometre 28. 41 minutes, 17 seconds down. That's a little bit of an interesting time.
Well, that's a surprise. This is Paolo Savoldelli. He's out on course as well. He's got a battened wheel in the front, a solid disc wheel in the back. The course is a very difficult course to manage because you've got a couple of rather difficult climbs halfway through. But this man here, Basso, is catching the man who started in front of him, and that is a rather impressive performance. He's gone through this point in 28 minutes and 22 seconds. It's his teammate who's actually winning at the finishing line at the moment, Dave Zabriskie, 58 minutes and 31 seconds.
He just picked up Christophe Moreni there. That was a good scalp to have. As we see Vladimir Karpic come in, 59-38, stops in the second place. He's developing into being a very good bike rider here, but Zabriskie is surprisingly still holding number one spot here. Minute seven better than Karpic, 1:23 on Decker.
Yeah, and Ruska up there in fourth place as well. He's also a very good individual time trialist. Danilo De Luca on the climb. He's been out on his bike for around about 16 minutes. Not the same style, is it, as Ivan Basso's, a very punchy style. This man is an explosive bike rider moving across, hoping the crowd will move out of the way. Paolo Savoldelli, he's also found over the last few seasons that his Achilles heel has always been the individual time trial, but his bonus is he can go downhill rather fast.
Now let's have a look at Basso's 28-kilometre check here. Zabiski, his teammate, has gone through, and Basso, at the same time, he must be hundreds of a second slower. I have to say, that is amazing. He's shown it 18 kilometres, over a minute out of it. That's also surprising.
Well, that's a surprise because he is, in fact, the Italian national time trial champion. This man here does not look to be going very fast at all. Danilo De Luca not at all comfortable on his machine in the early part of this course, but this is the climb. The climb is very difficult to manage for a lot of these riders. I think we're coming down to have a look here at Bouchagine as we head down towards the finishing line.
He's a good ride. No, it's Savoldelli. Well, Savoldelli is who's 28 kilometres here, and this is another good ride by Paolo. Zabriskie is the time to beat. Got it. Now that is a big surprise. I would never have expected that from Paolo Savoldelli.
Back to the finish line. This is Bouchagine. He's coming up and he's not going to challenge Zabriskie, but he is going to challenge there the time of Vladimir Karpec, who has got second place at the moment, all over his machine, Marcio, to Bouchagine. But it's a long way up this finishing straight, isn't it? He will do it. He'll move into second place. But Zabriskie now is looking like a very solid performance.
Well, Bouchagine's done this to us before with great performances like this. He's not a winner, but he is always up amongst it. And there he is again, slotting in, second place.
Well, if you can't recognise this position, you've not been watching cycling for very long, because this man uses the biggest gear ever in an individual time trial. He rocks the top half of his body. I just do not know how he turns over those massive gears, but he's not going to win the time trial here this afternoon.
No, he's not quite on form. He was at podium position last year. Sergei Honchar racing up, and he's losing a lot of time here because it's still a ways to go up the finishing straight with a flotilla of cars behind him, but there won't be any riders close to him. He's one of the best men at time trialing inside 25 metres, hits the line. Oh dear, no clock. So we'll have to wait and see what he did. Sorry about that.
Well, 18 kilometres covered. This is not a bad performance by Danilo De Luca. He's gone through there, Phil, with the fifth best time, only 26 seconds slower than the rider who had the best time at that point. Here's Dario Cioni coming up to 28.5 kilometres. He's gone through in 10th place. So he's not burning the road up here this afternoon, the Italian national time trial champion.
And Gonchar currently third at the moment with that ride, behind the leader and behind Richardine. Meanwhile, Basso might be delivering the big surprise of this race, and then I think we're all going to start talking about this man as a possible Giro winner, because his weak side was the time trial, and the clock is indicating he's up amongst it. 186 men surviving in the Giro, only 11 gone so far, and this is the last man on the road, De Luca.
Well, he's taking a lot of risks. He's getting himself into the aerodynamic position now, starting to look that little bit more explosive. We join here Paolo Savoldelli, who just a few moments ago recorded the best time at 28 kilometres. The time to beat at the finish line is still Dave Zabriskie, and everybody seems to be failing, Phil, over the last few kilometres.
Ooh, not a good time by Paolo Bettini. He's washed away here, 2:39 behind Zabriskie, well outside the hour. But Basso, I think, is going to sock us to the biggest surprise of the day.
Well, he looks good on the machine. He looks comfortable. That is a very aerodynamic position. But this man, not looking quite as good on the machine, just briefly there looking at Paolo Savoldelli, he was reporting some of the fastest times out on the course. Basso is not too far away. He's gone underneath the 1 kilometre to go banner, around about a minute apart from his own teammate Zabriskie.
Oop, forgot all about Cunego. We haven't seen too many time checks on him. This is at 28 and a half now. And Belli was in 13th, so he's not doing anything particularly stunning out on the course at the moment. But it's a question of who's beating him. Zabriskie's not going to worry him for the overall. Basso certainly will.
Well, Basso now inside the last 300 or 400 metres. He looks superb on that machine. The time he wants to beat is that of his own teammate. If he doesn't beat him, I don't think he'd be too worried. What's important for him is the time between himself and all of the other contenders for the Maglia Rossa.
This has got to be the best ever time trial by Ivan Basso in his career. And Bjarne Riis certainly has persuaded him well to get the best out of his body today, because I don't think he's not going to beat Zabriskie's time, but as Paul says, he's not going to worry about that. But it could be a 1-2 for CSC, and Bjarne Riis will take that, no problems. As he races up towards the line, he slipped outside the time. He's now looking at Bruchagin, 59.19. He's going to beat that for sure. This will be a second place for the moment, at least from Ivan Basso. Salvadelli might be a danger, he's still to come in, but for the moment Basso is in second place.
Well, you're right what you said there, Phil. This is the man's best ever individual time trial performance. Again, since he started riding the Tour de France, he's improved gradually in the individual time trial, but that was a great ride. Danilo De Luca goes through in sixth place at 28 kilometres. For me, that's a good performance by him, and he may well just be in with a chance of keeping his Maglia Rossa.
Wow, what about Savoldelli? He's also surprising us today. Interesting. Oh, leaky gas. I just wonder why we'll pop down there. We're probably behind Stefan Gartello at the moment, are we? No, we're behind the race leader. Almost forgot he was in the leaky gas squad. He always wears other colours jerseys. Danilo De Luca, here he is. It's true what Sean Kelly's always said. If you pull on a leader's jersey, you always ride a good time trial. Back to the finish at Salvadelli. He's dropped in behind the two CSC riders. He gets third at the moment. Outstanding for him. Only 44 seconds off the leader, who won't worry him in the mountains.
Well, that is a good performance. Let's have a look at it. Zabriskie leading his teammate Basso by 17 seconds and only 44 minutes lost so far by Paolo Salvadelli. Here's Cioni.
44 seconds, yeah.
A little bit surprising to me.
Well, only 27 seconds off Basso, which is more important. Cioni, well, he's going to keep up reasonable, but he's outside the hour there. Not great for the Italian time trial champion, I must confess. Here's Cunego racing up towards the line. He's also gone outside, though, Paul. He's looking about top 40, maybe just getting into the top 20 here, but it is the arrival, so he should make it. He's going to go below. Yes, Lefebvre is his next target, should beat him. 15th for Damiano at the minute.
Well, that's not a bad performance, because this man is not a great individual time trial. This is much stronger when it comes to the big mountains. But look at this explosion here. He's just about still inside the 1 hour. And De Luca, Phil, is looking at a top 10 finish.
He wasn't too far behind there. The man he's been chasing all day, Damiano Cunego. He's just going to be on the hour when he hits the line. I think it'll be good enough to hang on to the Maglia Rossa. And that's all he wanted to do today. He had his two stage wins. It's his second bite at the leader's jersey. He's just sailed over the hour, but to beat somebody like Jan Ruska, or he hasn't. Well, to beat somebody like Stefano Gartelli isn't that bad.
But it's going to be a big count now, but I think he's done just enough to keep himself in the Maglia Rossa for one more day, but it's going to be rather close. And what's happened with the individual time trial today is it's actually brought everybody just that little bit closer together.
Well, there's the situation. A win for Zabriskie. Another American victory added to Fred Rodriguez's win of a year ago. And the stage result, the big surprise, though, was Basso, his teammate, only 17 seconds slower. There's Dave Zabriskie, who's on a very successful CSC team this year, and that's his first ever stage win in a Giro d'Italia.
Well, the only reason he's been brought here, Phil, and there you can see Danilo De Luca has held on by just 9 seconds to Ivan Basso.
Well, good for him. I don't think Basso would have wanted the Maglia Rosa just yet. But Savoldelli, a big threat here, has now moved up. Remember, he won the 2002 Tour of Italy. Paolo Savoldelli. But for the moment, De Luca's dream continues here as he continues as the overall leader. No change at all in any of the leading classifications. There were no mountains. And Sven Kraus keeps his blue jersey. One day to go now before they get their first rest day, and this will take them through 1,500 kilometres covered of the roughly 3,500 that make up this year's Giro d'Italia. We're racing onwards now towards Ravenna, and a few undulations on the way as well. Just one big mountain in the middle, which will take them over 900 metres, then it's all downhill to the finishing line. But if the sprinters want the day, they'll have to cope with the climb first of all, I'm afraid.
Very impressed with the individual time trial performance of Danilo De Luca yesterday. But the sprinters have got themselves over most of the climbs of the day. They're pretty much organised at the front end of the peloton there. Right at the back, number 101, you can see Alessandro Patacchi on the wheel there of Baden-Cook. Eric Zabel, 219, over towards the left-hand side with 3 kilometres to go. And they seem to have got themselves organised on the front in the blue and white silver train.
Well, the only climb of the day was that mid-race climb. It wasn't covered by television, and it was won by Christiansen of Denmark, and Sven Kraus in the mix again. He got 2 points there, and he also got the Intergiro. So Sven Kraus keeps his lead in the Intergiro. He's been the only leader of this competition, but we haven't seen too much of the sprints, I'm afraid, because they've been too early on so far.
117 there. Baden-Cook seems to have recovered from the accident he had when he was taken out by Paolo Bettini. Bettini right on his tail there. In the golden helmet, the winner last year of the Olympic gold race, wrote the Olympic gold medal at the Athens Olympics. Fassa Bortolo got themselves organised, but I tell you what, Eric Zabel is always a threat when it comes to a sprint like this.
Well, embarrassed faces so far, and Pataki hasn't lost any of his enthusiasm. He's not even apologised. He says, look, it doesn't always work out. You hang on in there, you keep on trying. Well, he's trying again now, and once again, his team has not let him down, although they probably, we could say they did the other day when they all crashed. But right now, they've got line astern here, and it looks to me as though they're getting this one right. But watch out, Baden-Cook also is hooked up to the train. There he is, he's sprinting well. Zabel is in the mix as well, and so too Kessler is useful for him.
Marco Velo, Ongarato, they're all in the right position now to lead out Alessandro Patacchi, but there's always a huge battle on the wheel of Alessandro Patacchi, of all of the sprinters who want to take advantage of him there. You can just see wearing the Maglia Rossa, looking nice and comfortable, Danilo De Luca. I don't think he'd get involved in any of these sprints here. He's got a fairly good advantage over everybody else. Over to the right, T-Mobile moving forward as well. One or two riders from Rabobank, and it seems again, Phil, that Fassa Bortolo seemed to be losing control at the front end of this peloton.
Well, maybe the confidence has had a little bit of a knock here, and you've got to watch out for Jan Kersipu in that green and white, the Crédit Agricole colours, because he's been close and he hasn't quite made it, but he's sprinting very well this year.
So Stuart O'Grady. O'Grady is the rider in the red, white and blue jersey there on the wheel of Eric Zabel. Fassa Bortolo now down to three riders, but two of them will be leading out. Ongarato's right in the middle. Patacchi again has got his boys in control. Zabel's right there waiting to pounce in the pink.
It should be Marco Velo, the final man, to launch the bullet into space. And this time he's looking very good. They're building up the speed, but O'Grady is there in the coffin, his colours of red and white. And they're in a very, very dangerous position. Cookie's grimacing a little bit now, about five riders back. Kersipu is also in the mix, but the speed is on here. Zabel is best placed of them all now to try and take this. No sign, surprisingly, of McEwen. There he is over to the left and looking out of it now. McEwen is not going to get this one. Is this the one where Alessandro Patacchi gets it right? At 250 metres to go now, they're opening up the sprint. McEwen coming through right on the rails. That man gets out of trouble every time as he gets through. Now he's shoulder to shoulder with Patacchi. Bettini coming through, and Patacchi this time gets it. Well, He had a tremendous season last year. He's taken a while. I think it's more relief now than celebration. But Alessandro Bettacchi has got his win.
But once he clears out that turbo, he knows exactly how to open it up. Let's just have a look at this one more time. You can see McEwen. Look how far back McEwen comes from on the right-hand side. He's boxed up against the barriers. Now he's starting to open the sprint. But Bettacchi reminds me so much of one Mario Cipollini, because he leads from the front and challenges everybody to come by if you can. And you know what? Today, they can't.
But look at this, Bettini getting over the top of McEwen as well. Isaac Galvez was the rider there from Ilias Baleiras, who got sort of sandwiched out of it towards the end of the sprint. Well, as we watch again, another replay, there's the Ilias Baleiras rider, Galvez. Got a bit rough for him towards the end. Then came the Pocket Rockets, McEwen. And it was a very fast finish in the end, right through on the barriers. Look at Bettini coming through there, squeezing through. Perfect sprinting by both riders. Nothing untoward about that. And as we watch Bettacchi get the win, by the way, sad news for Discovery Channel, because Tom Danielson abandoned today. He's got a knee problem and he's on his way home on the eve of the rest day. There's the stage result. Bettacchi, Bettini, Oddly and Clerc for Fonak getting third. McEwen pushed back on the custom fourth for him.
And watch out for Griot from Ceramica Panari. He's getting himself up there in a consistent basis, and he's a man that they feel may well come up with a win a little bit later on. But Alessandro Bettacchi, Phil, do you think he looks relaxed?
I do. The only change of the day, by the way, was the stage winner. Everybody else kept their coloured jerseys. Today, De Luca keeps the pink again. Ivan Basso still in second place at 9 seconds. And Paolo Savoldelli, they're the big favourites now for sure as we go for the rest day here in Ravenna. Nice little teapot to hold with the crowd. Give us a smile.
Quite worried about the mountains coming up, and in fact Danilo De Luca has got himself the lead in the points classification by a single point from Robin McEwen, ahead of Paolo Bettini, who moves up into third place there. McEwen can have a threat to try and get that jersey, but it is the rightful jersey at the moment of Danilo De Luca.
Yeah, McEwen's been out of that jersey for 3 days, but he's got close. He needed better than fourth to pinch it. But that's not his aim in life. He wants more stage wins. In the mountains classification, Koldo Gil, who's now had the lead for 3 days, keeps his lead there. Rujano seems to be his biggest challenge at the moment. Venneberg, the first leader, for a couple of days, is still there in third place. Well, there we are, Koldo Gil. Liberty Seguros takes the King of the Mountains into the rest day. So, all suitably refreshed now, it's onward we go from Ravenna to Rossano Veneto, and this will take us up to 1,800 kilometres covered in this year's Giro.
Well, if you want a flat stage, you can't get very much flatter than this. This is almost like a pancake today's stage, certainly one stage that should be very much suited for the sprinters. But what is starting to loom are the big mountains on the horizon, when this race is going to get itself turned completely and utterly upside down. On the outskirts of Padova, before they head up towards the finish in Padova, it is an ideal day for the sprinters.
Yes, and the Intergiro again, taken out this time by Moreno Di Biasi. Sven Kraus not in the hunt, he just missed out, he was seventh today, but he still keeps his lead for the time being, the only lead of that competition, as we hop things up again now. Now, the boys have got their appetites whetted, good rest day for them yesterday, a little bit of limbering up, and here they are again, right on the front.
Again, it's the silver bullet of Fassa Bortolo, trying to look after that man there, number 101, right up there. You can see Robbie McEwen bouncing his way through. Robbie is such an agile rider. There's Stewie O'Grady over to the left-hand side, and they're trying to sort this one out. I think you can see Panari here trying to do something rather special for Griot.
Well, this is a huge lead out here, in fact, by Lancaster, who won the prologue. He's also a very good sprinter. He normally leads out, in fact, Graham Brown, who isn't here at the moment. He's trying to lead out Griot, but Griot's a little bit down the line just now.
Rida Griot there in about eighth position. And look at the bumping and barging there. One person you don't want to bump and barge with is Robbie McEwen, who is up into fifth place. He wants the wheel of Alessandro Bettacchi. He has to ride on his own. His teammates have completely disappeared now, but he knows if he can come out of the slipstream of Alessandro Bettacchi, he's got the win lined up.
One gets the feeling here that this might be a Bettacchi victory here, because the team have got themselves well organised. Under 1,000 metres to go to the line. They're flat out now at over 50 kilometres an hour. Griot is the rider in orange. O'Grady is the rider in white, red and blue flashes. Here's the lead out for Bettacchi. Now, where is Robbie McEwen? Zabel is off to the right of our picture there. as now McEwen is just beginning to pop into our picture, wearing his championship jersey. And now this surely is going to be Pataki's win number two as the race goes into its second phase.
Well, there's a split in the field there. McEwen's up in fourth, but look at, there's Griot bouncing and barging with everybody, but it is lining up to set itself up for Alessandro Pataki.
Yes, it looks as though Griot's taken a few tips from Graham Brown when it comes to sprinting here. But Bettini is still in there again. He's becoming quite a sprinter in this year's race. There he is, throwing his bike around, moving up on the centre left of our picture. And now, is this going to be a chance for Zabel? Because O'Grady's gone onto his back wheel. Bettini's on his back wheel. Here comes the Lord. Pataki's got the lead. It's going to be a tight finish, but I think McEwen's on the line. It could well be Robbie McEwen who snatched that right on the line. It was a very tight sprint.
Well, we have to have a look at that from the helicopter, because that was all in the lunge for the line. There's Bettini. He made himself top 10 or 15. We're looking down on Robbie McEwen there, the leader of the Chiclamina competition. The leader as the best rider in consistency on every individual stage. But that is Robbie McEwen just on the far side, and that is a very narrow margin there. I would say not very much more than 2 or 3 centimetres.
Inch perfect. Now that's a good way to beat Pataki, because not many riders have the speed to get over the top of Pataki, but he must have just taken it to the front a little bit too early. McEwen waited that split second longer. The final lunge has got it for him. That's the push. Where's the line? Oh, there it is. Yes, a perfect push. And Zabel off to the right. It looks like O'Grady off to the left.
Well, Robbie is such an incredible bike rider when it comes to judging how to lunge. And you know, if you can learn to lunge properly there, you can gain yourself half a metre in the last 5 metres. And McEwen really outstretching himself there to get himself what I would have said is around about a 3 centimetre victory over Alessandro Pataki.
Well, that's the sprinter's job done today, and McEwen gets sprint win number 3 here, which is a terrific result for him to win 3 stages of the Giro. Look at the face on Zabel, looks across to see who's beaten him this time. Poor old Eric, 22 second places last year, and he's back in the hat again this time around. There's the result, Eric finally being washed away to only 4th place. Bettini still sprinting well in 5th, and Galvez also sprinting well, but not quite quick enough. Robbie McEwen is still the man to beat, the Australian who lives in Belgium and wins in Italy.
In fact, wins almost anywhere he takes part in a bike race, Robbie McEwen, and he should get himself the Chiclamina jersey outright this afternoon. De Luca still leads the race by 9 seconds from Ivan Basso.
Indeed he does. The only jersey change overall is the Chiclamino has passed over to Robbie McEwen. Gill keeps mountains, Kraus keeps into Giro, De Luca keeps the pink jersey. Big test coming up though. Over 150 kilometres now, and we're into the mountains and a high mountain finish. So Danilo needs a good night's sleep. So as we start the 11th stage from Marustica to the Zoldo Alto, this is where we join the wildlife here in the natural parks of this beautiful country of Italy. The roads won't be quite as narrow as this, I can assure you, but the hills themselves will start at around 93 kilometres today with the Sereda Pass, and it keep on going right through towards the finishing line. This is when the tour, I suspect, really begins for the main contenders, Paul, because the mountains are with us for a few days now.
Yeah, this is a very difficult part. The riders have got 2 or 3 days in the mountains, and these are difficult climbs that the riders will be facing up to. These are the Dolomites right up in the top right-hand corner of Italy, and it makes a magnificent backdrop for the race. And this is where the stories and the race really does begin to unfold. Moving away from Marostica, it's quite an easy start, but it really is in the middle part of the course that it starts to get that little bit more difficult. The riders go through the valley roads as they head up towards the high spots. They've got around about 80 kilometres of undulating roads to get the legs warmed up before they all of a sudden start to go up to the high spots. There's the first climb of the day, followed very difficult by a 3.5 kilometre climb. But it's these passes, the Passo Duran, which goes up for 13 kilometres, where I expect a lot of the changes to take place.
And that will take them on to the finishing climb here. Well, there has been a breakaway, doing very well all day, including Benoit Jochen of Team Discovery Channel, and also José Rujano, who has done enough to take the race lead in the King of the Mountains off Coldo Gil for the first time. Kraus will keep his into Giro, but now is coming the battle towards the end, and there's been a total reshaping here at the front. And not surprisingly, we're not surprised anymore, Basso is in the seat.
Yeah, but look at that. The Maglia Rossa, Danilo De Luca, looking very comfortable, responded to all the moves in this group as well as Paolo Savoldelli. He's there in third place, rather a strange position, sitting right on the front end of his saddle. In there as well, Gilberto Simoni and Damiano Cunego. Just looking down there, I think that's also Rujano who's managed to stay in there. And this is a rider that this Cell Italia squad, Phil, are tipping as a star of the future.
Well, Basso right now is giving us every indication he's out to get the lead in the race today. But Basso, you've got to take your hat off to him because he is such a tough little competitor. Just sliding off the back there is Ardila. He's the Colombian rider who won two stages and the overall in the Tour of Britain last year. This year he's got promotion to ride in the big one, the Giro d'Italia.
Gilberto Simoni just over there on the right-hand side looking calm as a cucumber. And again, Ivan Basso, he wants this afternoon. He wants to get himself into that Maglia Rosa if he can. He must attack all of the way to try and get himself rid of Danilo De Luca, who is his limpet mind this afternoon.
Interesting that Cunego was up here, but he's dropped back and he's at 50 seconds now. Now, this is an interesting move because Simoni is up amongst it. But, you know, this is a good counter move. But just how many times can Basso launch an attack like this without hurting himself?
But he looks so good this afternoon. His time trial the other day was absolutely superb. He did exactly what he needed to do. This is the composition of the group. And it was Rujano was in there, number 43. Yeah. You see him. He rides for Colombia Cell Italia. Although looking down here, I think he's just about to pop.
Well, he's got to. He's the only man who's survived from the breakaway. He's done enough to give himself the lead in the King of the Mountains, but he is the only one left from the original breakaway today. These boys have come up from the main pack and they're riding extremely well right now, but I take my hat off to the pink jersey. He's riding superbly. He knows he's under pressure. Paolo Savoldelli is here as well, also riding well. Look at this, the determination on De Luca. You know, De Luca might do enough to keep his lead here. He's got to control Basso, of course. That's his main adversary today.
This is Atienza on the back, the rider from Cofidis, looking over his shoulder to see. But the damage is certainly being done here by Ivan Basso, not taking any prisoners at all. Well, I think we now know who is going to be the leader of Team Lampre, because Cunego today, Phil, is certainly under difficulty. And I think that will be a sigh of relief we'll hear this afternoon from Gilberto Simoni.
Well, after his remarkable year last year, including a win in the Tour of Lombardy, you can't repeat seasons like that, I think, when you're very young, as Damiano is. So maybe it's time to hand the reins back to the veteran, Simoni.
Paolo Savoldelli doesn't look very comfortable either. He's just struggling to try and stay in contact. And that looks like Rujano is coming back. Now, he is an amazing rider. He was in the breakaway early on, and he's pulling himself back up here, Phil, to the heads of state of the Giro.
Well, good for him. He knows he's got the lead in the King of the Mountains, and that's a big prize at the minute. This is a little bit further down the line here. And I must say that they're in trouble now because this group has been driven away by Basso, and if they don't put matters to rights, they're going to be in more than a spot of bother right now.
I think that was Wim van Huffel there, a new rider that I don't actually know very much about, a rider who rides for Lotto de Vitamont. As we move a little bit further up the road, that's still Ivan Basso, and they're now down to just four riders. And Paolo Savoldelli, although he seems to be in a spot of bother, has still not been completely dislodged from this leading group.
Well, he put in a good time trial, as did Basso, of course. They've got the first big hurdle behind them. They're more specialist in the mountains, so this is where they've got to now consolidate and show their skills. This is a very select little group, and if I'd have been a betting man, I wouldn't have bet that De Luca would have been with them. And yet there he is, the pink jersey rising to the occasion.
Rising to the occasion. I think this year he's risen back up to the top. Look at that. Coming back, there is Rujano. Now, remember that name? I think from memory, Rujano is only just 22 years of age. We expected to see him ride in the Tour de Lancawi last year, but unfortunately he had a nasty crash just before the start and wasn't able to participate. But he was pretty impressive this season. Van Huffel just behind. This is Patrice Albon. Rujano, look at him at the back here again. And he's struggling. He's got a very strange style. He's all over the machine. He's trying to keep himself in contact with the heads of state. And I think Paolo Savoldelli's gone.
It looks as though he's lost the gap there. He's cracked a little bit now. This is a lovely part of the area here as we climb through this natural park. And the group's now catching up the remnants of that breakaway as they continue. This is Cunego's group. He's the next group on the road, but he's lost ground. 75 seconds now, so he's lost a little bit more. And that's a lot to lose just now because the race could be going away from him.
And that's got O'Gill in there with the green jersey as leader of the King of the Mountains. That was the lead that he had this morning. I think De Luca's going here. This is not a surprise.
Well, who's doing the driving? Well, just still Basso. Nobody's helping him. Least of all Simoni.
Not even Gilberto Simoni. Simoni just sitting there.
Hello, welcome back. Is he coming back? Is he going back?
He's just trying to survive. He's got to find a decent rhythm now. I don't think he's able to stay on the terrible pressure that's being laid out to him by Ivan Basso. Basso not asking for any help at all, and there's the gap.
Well, he knows he's climbing up towards the line. He's got to hang on in there as long as he can. There's a young face there, Damiano Cunego, winner of the Giro last year, under pressure this time around, and he was showing signs of coming good, I thought. Well, De Luca may have been unhooked, but he isn't completely out of this. He's just trying to ride at his own rhythm.
Wants to try and survive.
Setting the pace.
Doing a job there for Damiano Cunego. But look at this. This is a man possessed. He wants to win the Giro d'Italia. This man, we've watched him over the last few years progress at the Tour de France, crashing out in his first participation, then finishing 11th, then finishing 7th. Look at that time gap back to Cunego.
Enormously now.
2 minutes. Gilberto Simoni does not look comfortable here.
That looked like 20 kilometres to go there on the side of the road. It might have been 30. As we're looking here at Basso, looking so compact and relaxed here. Even the great climber Simoni looks a little bit under pressure right now. This is a little bit further back because this is José Rujano. He's been joined by Paolo Savoldelli. That could be good news, in fact. 3 kilometres, sorry, as we're now seeing the finish here. We've moved further up the road. And Simoni hasn't done any help whatsoever. Rujano, we've seen race before in Asia, is a fabulous little climber with a body weight of about 44 kilos, that man. He's doing pretty well.
Well, these two riders are pulling themselves back up to the Maglia Rosa. Just caught a glimpse there of Danilo De Luca. What De Luca must do now is just forget about trying to stay in contact with these two men who are climbing much better than he is this afternoon, but getting himself into a rhythm so he doesn't lose too much time. And I think that's exactly here what Paolo Savoldelli has done, because he's brought himself back to the Maglia Rosa. De Luca not looking as stressed as he was a few moments ago. I think he's decided to raise the white flag and just try and see if he can find a comfortable rhythm.
Well, can he hang on to Paolo? Paolo's back, found his legs. He's dropped off. He's got back into his green zone where he can dictate the pace. And it's quite likely he can recover here and get back up with them. This is Basso. This is a serious move by Basso. This is a planned move. He'll be a little upset that he's not getting any assistance from Simoni, but I don't suppose he will expect any.
I don't suppose either that the man who wears number 2 this year can give any help at all for the moment. He's just quite happy to stay in second position. And in fact, he's starting to open up the gap. You know, Gilberto Simoni this afternoon is also now being put under pressure. Paolo Savoldelli riding a sensible pace, and Danilo De Luca just hoping he can stay on the wheel of little Rujano, who's just in front of him.
They've all come down to their own level here now, and sometimes on a long climb you can lift it a little bit, but little and slowly, because otherwise you'd be back in the red zone. Well, Basso's done it all today. This has been his day, man of the match, as they say. He's done all of the attacking. He's delivered attack after attack until he finally broke the spirit of everyone except Simoni. And Simoni will have the ability to fly in the last kilometre.
De Luca's gone again. Danilo De Luca under pressure, the crowd trying to egg him on, the Tifosi here in Italy trying to encourage the man who has worn the Maglia Rosa for the last couple of days, defended it in the individual time trial, but it's in fact the little Venezuelan Rujano now who's lifting up the pace.
Well, good for him, because he's hurt them all and he knows he's got a green jersey waiting for him at the finish. Rujano riding extremely well at the moment. Basso looks pretty calm and collected. He's just relaxed on the bike. I think
he's comfortable now with the team. He's happy with his relationship with Bjarne Riis. And every time I see him race, I remember what Giancarlo Ferretti said. Why should I have a rider like Ivan Basso? He doesn't win races and he never attacks. Well, I think Giancarlo must be thinking differently today.
Well, Savoldelli is all of a sudden having to sit behind the Venezuelan rider there. He was behind them all, remember. He was in the original breakaway and he's found his legs to get back through the pack. And they're opening up very slowly a gap on the Danilo De Luca, but not by a big margin, and they're running out of time.
Well, De Luca mustn't panic.
A little signal there, Paul. Yeah. A little signal from Basso. I don't know whether he was just saying, come and give me a hand or what.
I think he wanted him to come forward, set a little bit of the pace, making 2 kilometres to the summit. magnificent backdrop here. These are such savage climbs. They're beautiful climbs because of the nature of this part of the world. The time gap, Phil, is not great. It's only 15 seconds back to Rujano and number 71 there, Paolo Savoldelli.
He's pulling them back.
He is.
I don't know where he's found the legs. There it is, 20 seconds to De Luca. They could all come together here.
It's only a further 5 seconds back to Danilo De Luca. He is not panicking at the moment. He's trying to stay calm. Yet you see, Basso, that's another indication of that hand. He wants now Gilberto Simoni to come forward. I don't think Simoni can, but Basso is trying to force him forward.
Well, the graffiti artists have been out today. I'm sure the winter snows will take care of that, though. As we're now looking down at a fantastic day by Ivan Basso. Terrific pacemaking, but when the cameras pan back, there's the chase now. And it is the Venezuelan José Rujano who is actually pulling Paolo Savoldelli back up to the leaders. And that's a big return, because Rujano won't be seen as a winner of the Giro. But you know, Paolo Savoldelli's done it before, so must be considered.
And here's Danilo De Luca. He's only about 3 or 4 seconds, and he seems now, look at the rhythm, Phil, he seems to have got himself back in. The funny thing is about a non-pure climber is certain gradients are better suited to you. Now, this man was put into difficulty, and I think as we get to the slightly easier incline, he's getting himself into a rhythm that's pulling himself back into this race.
Well, as the summit approaches, we're heading up towards the mountain, and then we've got a short descent and then the action of the finishing climb. And there's a massive crowd out here, and the clock is counting, I think, over the top. And this is where De Luca will get back. He will rejoin here easily, no problems. And we all know how well Il Falco descends. So are they going to close the gap and take 5 men to the last climb?
De Luca's back. Look at that. This is what the Maglia Rosa, the leader's jersey, when you pull it onto your shoulders, you get a little bit of extra strength and a whole lot more courage. Danilo De Luca has pulled himself back to Paolo Savoldelli and José Rujano. And you know, I make it around about 12 seconds between them and this leading group on the road.
I'm just looking there. That's 1 kilometre to go here now. So that was not the actual summit call. We've still got that false flat, then this thing, then we go back up again. So that wasn't the top of the climb.
It certainly wasn't the top
so
of the climb.
So they'll take advantage to close the gap, though, because they've got this little undulation
what
here.
Gap?
Well,
they're
there
here.
We are. They're all message over.
5 men
here
back
come
in
the troops.
Front.
And look at this. Rujano, who wants those King of the Mountains points, has gone straight back to the front. It's almost as if he knew there was that little respite before the actual run up to the top.
Well, this man, he might be small in stature. He actually weighs 48 kilos. But I tell you what, he's not worried about the reputations of the men with him. He's gone straight to the front. He's inside the final kilometre to the summit of this climb, and he wants maximum points if he can. And Danilo De Luca, Phil, how good is he going to feel that he's got 3 minutes advantage over Cunego?
Well, this has hurt Cunego, and it looks like it's curtains for him too if he continues to lose at this rate, because we've still got the finishing climb to come. And this is going to put the boys in big trouble here, because this is the first big move of this year's Giro. And Danilo De Luca in the pink is right there tagged on. I can't see him hanging on up the final climb, but you never know. He could be inspired.
He could be very much inspired. But José Rujano is looking at the top here of the Paso Duran at 131 kilometres of today's stage covered. It's a first category climb. And who would have thought that the little man from Venezuela is dictating to the pace to the heads of state, Ivan Basso, Gilberto Simoni, Danilo De Luca and Paolo Savoldelli.
Now, if we get to the next climb as a group of five, it'll be as if somebody threw a firework in the middle of them, because they'll race for the summit one-on-one, I think, as they continue up towards the end. There's the long line now. Now, will they bother to attack the Venezuelan, who's built up a winning lead? Not a winning lead, but a lead in the King of the Mountains just now.
Danilo's suffering.
Come on, Danilo, don't let it go now, because you can see the finish. And look at him try, as he tries to hook up a game with Savoldelli.
He's turning himself inside out at this moment. He's done an incredible job this afternoon. Not a lot of people gave him a chance of keeping the Maglia Rosa here this afternoon on the first big mountain stage. But what he's doing is currently doing that. There are points for Rujano. Basso goes across there in second place. Third place, Simoni. Paolo Savoldelli. And just tucked on the back, Danilo De Luca. I wonder now if Paolo Savoldelli is going to use his descending ability to try and falsify his company with that leading group of five.
Well, this is Pietro Coccioli further back here, and he is the rider signed this year by Crédit Agricole for this very race, and he's trying to put matters to right, because he's allowed a little group to go away. But he's certainly best of the rest right now and hasn't lost as much as poor old Damiano Cunego as he climbs up the climb here with Atienza.
Daniel Atienza, Spanish rider on the Cofidis squad, a man who in the past has always ridden rather well at the Giro d'Italia. They're just inside around about 100 metres to the summit, but they've lost themselves almost a minute on that group of five riders, but there's going to be a massive change in the top 10 of the overall classification this evening.
Well, it's the summit of the climb. Remember, five have gone over the top. Atienza, Calcioli over there behind, just on 1 minute the gap. It's going to be a long wait there for Damiano Cunego, and there's still the last climb to come. This is a big push now for some of the favourites, and there are three of them here, in fairness. I wouldn't count De Luca as being a race favourite overall, but this man going down could be rated one of the best descenders in the world, and look at him chop the apex off these corners.
Il Falco is his nickname, the Falcon, because of the way he plummets out of the skies from the summit of these climbs down to the valleys below. He has absolutely and utterly no fear, and he can certainly go downhills very fast indeed. In fact, the man in the team car behind him, Sean Yates for Team Discovery Channel, also used to go downhills rather fast, but Il Falco there, Phil, he's putting a lot of pressures on that riders or those riders with him.
The way he's looking over his shoulder, that is an attack. He's really stretching the riders there to make a mistake. And I don't think Rujano will manage to go down at those sort of speeds. Well, I think we're probably back with the Cunego group here. And it's at 2 minutes at the moment. Coldo Gill is here. He's out of that green jersey now. There's Cunego off to the far right in the blue. He's still further down, though. Meanwhile, 2:07 ticks by.
Kessler just going through there, 2:10, but it is still going to be around about the 3 minute mark before we see Damiano Cunego.
The future winner of the Giro is in that front group of five right now.
Absolutely, and it could very well be Ivan Basso, the way he's ridden with such a dominating style since the start of this race. It's a pity though that little Rujano lost so much time in the early few days of the race, because they would start to look at him as a serious threat. Now look at the gap here. This is De Luca, this is Basso. They're not quite as good as going around these corners as Paolo Savoldelli. I just caught a glimpse of Savoldelli. He's not that far off the front, maybe 5 or 6 seconds, but he's not taking any prisoners.
Well, if he gets to the bottom of the climb alone, he can climb as well as descend. That could really be a great coup for the Team Discovery. They've lost Tom Danielson, who we were expecting to really excel in this year's Giro d'Italia. Hasn't been. There's number one. Quite content to ride with Tonti, number five, his teammate, who's ridden pretty well here. He's obviously been designated to look after last year's champion.
It's Charlie Wagelis at the back, number 159.
Well done, Charlie.
Wagelis has always ridden well at the Giro d'Italia. Look at the time, though, 3 minutes and 17 seconds. So that's big time chunks going away for Damiano Cunego.
Well, we know who the leader of the Lampre team is now. Simoni, the winner of this race 2 years ago, is now the protected rider for sure.
Absolutely. As we go down, we rejoin here. This is Gilberto Simoni himself. Phil, not a bad descender, but I think he's been put under pressure. I can't believe that Paolo Savoldelli is not off up the road, because Savoldelli is the best descender. There's Savoldelli just going around that corner, but these two men both go downhill pretty fast. Simoni, as a climber, is probably one of the best descenders of his group of men, but this man is the best descender in the world currently on the circuit.
Mad, crazy, kamikaze, call him what you like. This man can take time out of the best riders in the world going downhill, and he has the climbing ability to finish it off. And that's his plan, is to not attack them on the way up, because people like Simoni and Basso can climb as well. It's to beat them on the descent and then use his climbing power to stay clear on the way up to the line.
Well, I don't think he'd regard himself as being mad or crazy. I think he's just having a little bit of fun here this afternoon, because he knows that he has the ability to go downhill fast. He looked over his shoulder there. It's a very special gift being able to go downhill fast. And a lot of it is to do with your nerve, but a certain proportion is to do with your position on the machine, making sure that your center of gravity is in an ideal position. He's looked over a couple of times there to see just exactly where Gilberto Simoni is. You can see Paolo Savoldelli is not one of the greatest climbers in the world, but he's used this downhill ability over the last number of seasons to keep himself in contact with the big men in the big mountain passes.
Well, he's not afraid to crash. He's had his first share of crashes over the years and broken bones, and in fact he hasn't won a race since he won the Giro d'Italia, which is way back in 2002. And to cross the line in a race, he hasn't done that since he won a mountain time trial just after he won the Giro d'Italia. He didn't win any stages in the Giro when he won this tour in 2002. So this could be a big return and a big way of saying thank you to Johan Bruneel, perhaps.
For having confidence in him. He tried to bring Paolo Savoldelli into the squad a couple of seasons ago, but he wasn't able to get him away from Alexia Alumina, which was probably a major mistake, although he did win the Giro d'Italia for that team. Here you can see that Rujano has disappeared from this group. This is Basso, Simoni and Danilo De Luca still keeping himself in there, and they've got around about a 15-second deficit on the man who leads the event.
Well, he's made his move. He's got his gap. The boys are reforming at the back now to decide quite what they're going to do. Very shortly, we'll start our climb up towards the line. This is an intriguing way to win a stage of the Giro d'Italia, I must say, and he's very confident to have gone. But for a man who can descend well, this is a perfect descent. The roads are narrow, the surface is good, and it's plenty of twists and turns. You're out of sight very quickly. De Luca there hanging on to two flyers in Basso and Simoni. But we have, as I thought, Paul, we have lost Rujano, who couldn't go down with these boys.
Well, he's got a definite handicap of not being quite as heavy as the other riders in the group with him. He weighs less than 50 kilos, and that's a serious disadvantage when you're going downhill at around about 60 miles an hour. Danilo De Luca there in the Maglia Rosa has recovered. He's stuck onto the back wheel of Gilberto Simoni, and Ivan Basso seems to have recovered, although he's improved his time-trialing ability. Seems to have lost a little bit of his downhill skills.
Well, just one car keeping an eye on affairs now. Neutral service, I would think, looking after the majority, although it looks like it's CSC team car. Back with the leader now. Must be a very lonely man down here. I would think he's got no service. If he does have a flat tyre, he'll wait for the group. So he continues to descend. 10 kilometres to go to the finishing line. 6 miles. But the vast majority is uphill. He'll shortly be changing direction and starting the climb.
Well, this is a big risk for Paolo Savoldelli because he's moving
it's a brave one.
All of the effort on the downhill part of the course. He hasn't really opened up a huge gap. He's been chased by Simoni, De Luca and Basso. And I would say Simoni and Basso could recover on the last few kilometres uphill and pull Savoldelli back into the fold. I'm just looking over on the left-hand side to see if I could catch a glimpse of Rujano, but he seems to have disappeared while this man... If you can use 99.8% of the road, he's using that right now.
Well, I'll tell you
just
what.
Watch this.
It's a bit tight. Ah! Trying to get the tightest line, he realised they hadn't made that barrier quite round. And he had to flick a little bit, but he's done it safely. And here's Danilo De Luca, not sure whether he's in the front. No, he's behind. See, he's also, and he, remember, he broke his collarbone in the Tour de France descending on a descent like this, Paul.
Yes, he did. It's so very difficult when you're going downhill on a tyre that measures in at less than 1 inch. It's 9 kilometres to go to the finish now as we whip down into town. Salvatelli, watch the way he goes over to the right-hand side, cuts the apex of the corner very narrowly. The reason he does that is to make sure he doesn't lose too much impetus, to keep the pace as high as possible. But now, unfortunately, it's no longer downhill. We're starting to kick up towards the finishing line, and this is a climb of almost 9 kilometres.
A maximum 11%, an average of nearly 7%. This is no easy climb. There's the change of direction now. The others are probably about 10 or 12 seconds back, maybe slightly more, judging by the corner.
Yep, they've got to get themselves organised, but we did see on the previous climb that Ivan Basso was in excellent form. Simoni may well have recovered. After all, Simoni has won a lot of mountaintop finishes in his career. Savoldelli is holding on to a mere 19 seconds advantage. And once you've gone downhill for a long time and the road suddenly kicks up, it doesn't half hurt the legs.
And you can imagine how the legs are feeling right now. He's got to concentrate on this now and get himself into a rhythm. He's laid his cards on the table today. He's a past winner of the Giro. And this is a serious bid to try and take the Maglia Rosa. He's shown us a great time trial. Johan Bruneel will be encouraging him. Or rather, Sean Yates will be encouraging him. Johan's not here. Sean Yates is the manager of the race today.